bottom line is, people, I'm telling you right now, Father needs people who are going to begin to allow the Holy Ghost to develop within them an ability to take hold on Him. Father's made a way to where everybody can take hold on Him, but there's only a few people who's ever done it. There's only a few people who are moved by the Holy Ghost to do these things. Because, you run out of strength quickly when you begin to pray earnestly. You know what that is? It's like going for a run and you're not in shape. And you stop, you're going to go for 2 miles, and you stop in one block. You don't make 2 blocks. Are you with me? That's what it is. But what happens if you, here's how you know people who give themselves to prayer. They can pray intensely for long stretches of time because they don't pray by their own ability. It's the Holy Ghost fuel. It's the Holy Ghost fuel. Now, I tell you right now, God's going to have some people that are willing to give themselves to prayer and to faith. You know, there could be people that are ministers of the word, you know what I'm saying, of the letter that kills. They're not able ministers of the spirit because they've never been willing to give themselves over to the flow of the Holy Ghost. They're stuck in a human realm. So tonight, I just want you to let God speak to you about the fact that you have not because you ask not. And I want you to begin to start thinking about when you are with Him, are you asking Him about the things that He has for you and wants for you? Are you asking Him for the things that He wants, that He desires? What's going on? Or do you run out of things of asking? I guarantee you, begin to give yourself to asking for the things of the kingdom. It will converge. Prayer, all prayer and supplication in the Spirit will begin to converge on faith. And we'll begin to have men and women who know how to lay hold on God instead of having, you know, somebody said junior varsity. Wait, junior nursery. Because if I look at the qualifications of the Scripture, if I look what the Scripture describes, I'm just seeing that's where we at. We basically, the church by and large, have the fruits of babyhood. We do. Because if I preached on them, it's kind of a not a very inspiring issue. Well, it's inspiring for me because it's like, I don't want to be that. But if I started going through all the verses of Scripture that describes infancy in the things of the Spirit, we look a lot like that. And we're going to have to, and you know what? Only in realities, I think people get sad because when I say things like this, I think people get sad because they do not want to change. Because the reality of it is, for you to be different than what the status quo is in the church, you got to be radically different. You got to learn how to give yourself to long stretches of prayer and do it. You know, I was thinking about this last night. We're just going to go ahead and sing worship song but I was thinking about how many people, you know, Daniel couldn't resist. He had such a fellowship with Father. He could not imagine having to go for any length of period of time without praying 3 times a day. He couldn't imagine it. And so it was like somebody stealing him from his dearest romantic love. And there's just really not that many people on the earth that are even anything like that right now. And we got to change that. And I have, and you must. It's a decision that you have to make. And so I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll make it. First part of it's hunger. What do you do when you begin to have within yourself spiritual indicators that you're not hungry? What do? You begin to ask Father for hunger. Because guess who spiritual hunger comes from? You think it's resident somehow on the inside of you that somehow you can have it if you pull enough hair out? Somehow it's resident on the inside of you that you can have it if you do something humanly possible? No, you ask. And then what happens? You break the barrier because you're like, Lord, I need the hunger. Maybe that's the whole prayer time. God, I need the hunger. Father, I need to be stirred with the hunger. I need to be stirred with the hunger that's like a passion. It's like a fire shut up in my bones. Oh, God, do it. Oh, God, do it. Father, and then you just start talking to Father about all the reasons why you need to be hungry. I was just thinking today about all the prayers, the different kinds of prayers that different people prayed. I was thinking specifically today about Jacob's prayer as he's getting ready to meet Esau, and how he had so many divine encounters, but yet he goes reminding God of all that he went through and all the Father had promised. And he said, Lord, I know I'm not worthy of any of your mercy and of any of your loving kindness and any of the things that you've given, but I'm asking you to care for me today. You know, and it's just beautiful. It's beautiful when you look at all the different prayers and then the simplicity of it. But most all of them are always at work in the most intense crisis. You see what I'm saying? And there's a place, though, to where that the intensity of the need of heaven bears upon our soul, that we don't have to have crisis, an earth crisis. We're in a heavenly crisis, as it were, to fully step into all that Father has for us, to not live less than what He's blessed us with, all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm to have. If we'll take hold on, if we'll make Father, and really a big part of hunger is, and I believe that the Lord holds back a lot of it, is because Father looks for us to put Him first. He's waiting. It's like, yeah, I know what you're saying, but you know, I've watched you all day. I've watched you all week. I've watched you all month. Can we get some change here? And that's really what it comes down to. It's like Israel demanding God to hear their prayers while they've got their idols in the back room. You hear what I'm saying to you? There's like, He has to hear our prayers too. We're His people. And the prophet's going, no, you're not. They're going, yeah, we are. And we're going to beat you up for saying we're not. But Father's just looking for adjustments made in our life. That's all. And if we'll make the adjustments, whew, come on, man. You have to ask this question. Can you live your life and go through your existence without having what Jesus Christ described is supposed to be produced through your life? And number one, your individual impact upon the lost has the same potential that was expressed through Paul. Are you willing to continue on with your life as it is? And if you are, you're never going to be able to lay hold on these things that are available. If you're not, you know what it's going to do? You want to do? It will drive you to your knees. Hunger, physical hunger, will drive us to the table. Spiritual hunger will drive us to our knees. It's true. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Ooh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, 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 I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. With fellowship, what joy divine that I am Jesus' and He is mine. With blessedness, what peace so free that I'm in Jesus and He's in me. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. 'cause I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Your arm to love.
Peace and joy.
ghost of the Almighty. I serve the King of glory, and I'm for Him and He's for me. Oh yes, I serve a great big God. I serve the Almighty. I serve the King of glory, and I'm for Him and He's for me. Oh, and it's joy all the time. Oh, a good, good time. All the best of times in Jesus. All the joy. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. When 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saith the Jesus, Jesus, how I trust You, how I'm proved You, all and all. And Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust You, how I'm proved You, oh, and Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, to try.
ögonen är pixet att vara på det här fiti. Det är extra att vara
present, present, your presence.
all-consuming fire burning me, all-consuming fire burning me, all-consuming fire burning me, all-consuming fire burning me. Oh, burn, burn, burn in my soul.
Living sacrifice.
But here's my life, a living sacrifice. When our God is a consuming fire, our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God, He is a consuming fire. Our God, He is a consuming fire.
The great I am. Alpha and Omega, the beginning. Consuming fire, oh, our God
is a consuming fire. Our God,
He is
a consuming fire. Our God,
He
is a consuming. Consuming fire.
Yes, said on a man, hear him. Yeah, that I see, said a man, done. He never sat to the man, there, a man, there, also. He never ran. He never said a lot to the survey, the man, and I. He never did so. He never saw. Mi balala basu tor si dana man, kire balala basi break, kire balala su tor man dana nene, kire balala kuso tororo, kire bay, si ne balala kusi, we adore you, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of worshiping you by the Holy Ghost. And we thank you, Lord, for the honor of speaking unto you. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of worshiping you by the Holy Ghost, of access to you by the Spirit, to have your favor. Oh, God, we adore you, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We adore you, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We adore you, Lord, we adore you. Lord, we adore you. Lord, we adore you. Just go ahead and begin to worship the Lord with me a little bit and worship him in Amasatananea. What shall we do then? We will sing in the spirit. Hallelujah. And we'll sing with the understanding all songs. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your love and grace. Thank you, Lord, for your spirit and power.
Let the Lord dig into you right now. Let him just sink his bit into your life spiritually and begin to dig deep. If you'll let the Spirit of the Lord begin to dig into your life, I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to hit water.
Oh, Lord Jesus, baptize her in the Holy Ghost and fire. Come do your work right now. Baptize her in the Holy Ghost and fire. Come do this work in me, oh God.
Well, thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that you've given into us. Well, you know, the thing about it is, dear people, is we tonight, the Spirit of the Lord so wants to call you into a place, but you've got to be willing to come there. I mean, you've got to be willing to make the changes. You've got to be willing to make the adjustments. Otherwise, you'll just hear and it won't bring anything in the doing and in the working within your life. And it'd be a great disappointment. The change won't come. But if you'd listen tonight, if you'd let the Spirit of the Lord begin to speak to you. You know, I was thinking yesterday about how Daniel had such a walk with the Lord that it was unimaginable for him to think that he would have to be somehow go without praying 3 times for a day. When a decree went forth that no one could offer any petition for, I don't know what it was like a month or something like that. No one could offer any petition whatsoever, and his adversaries knew, as adversaries plotting against him, because they knew what kind of a guy he was. But see, he had allowed something. You listen to me tonight, because I'm going to tell you, listen to me. Because it's something that you've never allowed in your life, and if you'll allow it, it will change your life. His romantic interest, his love relationship with the Lord was so much that he would rather be eaten by lions than to think that he would have to go without prayer for one day. I don't know that there's any such people on the face of the earth, or there's very few such people on the face of the earth today, that have really made the transition from just the prayer that that people pray religiously to the affectionate love and adoration that is fueled by the Holy Ghost, by all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Now listen, I want to help you tonight. I want to help you. I'm praying that people will just stay in the meeting. I'm praying, it's like, I get this urge. Maybe I could say everything I need to say in 1 hour and 5 minutes. But I would be talking so fast that there's no way that anybody understand a single thing that I have to say. But I want you to know something. The Holy Ghost is here to talk to you tonight. And if you're all convoluted and compromised by the world, what I'm saying isn't going to have a big impact. But if there's something that's going on in your life called hunger and thirsting after righteousness, if there's something that's called spiritual hunger in your life, and I really believe that there is, I believe that by and large you're not just here because you're committed Christians. Because there's people that are faithful and they're just committed Christians and they never move beyond committed Christians. They never mature into being ambassadors of Christ and ministers of the Holy Ghost. People, I look at you and I watch your lives and I see when you get fiery and I see when gifts of the Spirit begin to operate in your life, and then I watch when it starts to take a nosedive, or I watch when it just kind of drifts, or I watch when you feel just stuck, you don't know what to do. And tonight I'm going to show you in a very practical way exactly what God wants of you and what He wants you to do. And I want you to see key as an instrument, instrumentally a key to be able to help you understand what you need to be doing. Look at Daniel's life. There needs to be people who know how to lay hold on God. There needs to be a spiritual growth and maturity that only comes by way of relationship with the Lord Jesus, with the Father and with the Holy Ghost, that is actually formed, developed, and matured in a place of prayer, in a place of the study of the Word. But it's not just prayer, because it's prayer that is moved out of a fellowship and relationship that produces an outworking of faith. Because there's a lot of people who pray. They stand at the wailing wall praying, wailing, and nothing's happening. Because there's no faith there. There's no relationship. Why did Jacob's simple little prayer that he prayed, why did it have such an impact? Because he had such a relationship. It was a simple little prayer. Why did Peter's simple little prayer have such a huge impact that the whole place was shaken inside of a few minutes of a prayer? Because he had a relationship. Because there were certain people, there's been people who've allowed a relationship with God to develop in their life to where that they literally have power in heaven and they move God. I mean, James puts it like this. He says, you have not because you ask not. And there's no way to simplify this more than that. And listen, I mean, it gets passionate when you let the Holy Ghost fuel it, because I watch people, they try to rise up to it. Bless your heart, you try to rise up to the moment of prayer, and you need to. You need to do whatever you need to do. But it will come to a place where it's not you burning out in 5 to 10 to 15 minutes. It's something that is the flow of the Holy Ghost. It causes you, it gets stronger with every passing minute. Your body gets healed. If you're tired, you get refreshed. I mean, it's a river of life. When you look at the river of life, look, by the time that the tribulation is done, the earth will be decimated. There won't be anything left on it. It'll basically be decimated. But the river of God will go out from the throne of God out of Jerusalem, and it will heal all the land. It's the one thing that I liked about the new Noah movie, because I watched it over and over again, just the first part, because I said, that's it. That's exactly what it's going to be like, or similar to what it's going to be like. They got that part right. That was the only part they got right. This river goes out, a spring comes up, and a river goes out, and it heals all the land. That's what the river of God will do for us. People say they want to have all these excuses about how they're tired and how they're weary and how they got all these things to do and how they're under the gun, how they're under pressure, and how they're multitasking, how they're run out of energy. People, I've got your answer tonight. You want to be seated? I'm happy to give it to you. I want to deliver it. I would like to deliver to you what I've received from the heaven. What I've received from God, I would like to deliver to you. Oh, people, I'm going to tell you right now, I tell you, I do get a little bit jealous and provoked by the way the Haredi community. They do it wrong because they don't want nothing to do with you. They don't want nothing to do with you and me. They're very snobbish and not touching the goyim. but among themselves. They know how to do community. And it is a simple expression to me of how we're supposed to do community with God. Not so much when we're doing community with God, when we've made what He has made important to our own lives. Oh, then that begins to develop even into a larger impact to where that there is a fellowship only with people of the Spirit. And you really don't have a fellowship with anyone else. You can have love for them. You can be good and kind to them, but there's no fellowship. There's no intimacy there. And I mean, you know, it's so important to begin to understand that, but you can never understand it until you understand it in the context of a relationship with the Lord Jesus. I mean, I want to just look real quickly and just show you something. You know, I mentioned Daniel, but look at Jeremiah chapter 15. Let me show you a verse of scripture there. Because the Lord in Jeremiah chapter 15, He highlights three guys. He highlights three men who had come to a place in their life where they knew how to lay hold on Him. And of course here it might only be two. He might not bring up Daniel here. Then said the Lord unto me, though Moses and Samuel stood before me, my mind could not be towards this people. Cast them out of my sight. And I don't want to talk about the negative part of it, because ultimately people do run ruin. You can misrepresent and profane the name of the Lord just so long, and He draws a line under it. People think that they're getting away with stuff. Nobody's getting away with anything. Father has many witnesses. Some of you are watching me by the web tonight. You've got your own decisions about what you believe is right with God based upon your denomination, your doctrinal opinions, and your ideas. Some people that even in this place have the same thing, but you're still without excuse, because the Word of God is very clear. And if you begin to really go after God because you really wanted to know Him, all these other religious things that you believe and that you use as an excuse for why you don't grow closer to Him and come to know Him like the Word of God describes that we're supposed to know Him, they would all fall off. It would just all be irrelevant. See, people make up a facade. That's nothing new. We watch that all over the place. People create for you. They'll be whatever you want them to be so that they can get your vote. They'll be whatever you want them to be so that they can, you know, befriend you for some reason or other. Out of some self-gratification motive. I'm sorry. It's unfortunate that that's the way it is. But love is only found in the kingdom of God, which you and I are supposed to have plenty of. Now, listen, people, I want you to know, just I want you to understand that I praise God that you continued on with the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. But you know what? Father has purposed to cause you to be able to lay hold on Him as much as anybody in the past, Moses, Samuel, Daniel, as much as Paul, Stephen, Philip, you name them. The Lord didn't give out junior salvation. Somebody said it's junior varsity. No, it's not. It's junior nursery. It's junior nursery. It's because we came in to salvation, but we didn't allow God to take us and develop us and mature us. Because what happens, as soon as you see in the history of men where somebody, some woman, some man, begin to allow God to develop them, you begin to see great exploits. You begin to see great miracles. You begin to see things that were unprecedented in history. Listen, Mariah Woodruff Eder preached when no women could preach, and the place was packed out. I mean, she was evangelist. I mean, when she tried to pastor, Holy Ghost people can't have big churches pastoring. Holy Ghost churches, Holy Ghost people, here, let me tell you this is a sad reality. By and large, Holy Ghost people cannot have big churches if they're pastoring. It's too intense for people. It sorts people out right away. They can have big meetings. Mariah Ether tried to have a pastorate, small. John G. Lake tried to have a pastorate, small. Evangelists, on the evangelistic field, tent meetings, big. Anywhere they go with that, big. Why won't somebody somewhere be willing to allow that to change? And I'm going to talk to you tonight about how that changes. I'm going to talk to you about confronting you, what you have not been willing to do. You've not been willing to deny yourself. By and large, you've not been willing to deny yourself. The reality of it is the guard goes up and say, oh, yeah, I have. No, you haven't. Because when you do, change begins to take place. What happens as you begin to obey God and you begin to do basic things that God shows you to do, suddenly your heart and your eyes and your affections begin to be open to an heavenly realm, and you go, wow, this is really beautiful. I'm starting to get why Daniel was really in love with prayer. I'm starting to get this. I'm starting to get this, why this was so important to him that he was willing to be thrown to lions rather than to be without it. I mean, I think it's almost reverse. I think sometimes it's like people just throw me to the lions rather than to pray. I don't know. I do know what God says. He says, ask of me and I will give you the nations. And it's no more complicated than that. Listen to me. Listen to me. Stay with me. Stay with me. I've got to get you to a point where somehow you will grab a hold of your life and yourself and all that you know, and you'll place it over in God, and you'll allow God to take that and bring it into a together thing so that we can move together, so that somehow something will happen that everybody's heart and affections get united with that of the Lord Jesus Christ, because they're divided. They're diverse. We've got all of our occupations, all of our goals, all of our bank accounts, all the things that we're going to do so grandiose and big for God, but never get done. You know what? Just look at the history. It's repeated over and over and over again. All these people, they were going to do these great things for God as soon as they got this one milestone or one, this one event or that other thing happened, and it never took place. And then all of a sudden, they turned around. They were going to go to the mission field by no later than the age 25, and then they turned around, and all of a sudden, they were 75. What happened at the time? Yeah. You know what? You're going to have to obey God. You're going to have to stop what you're doing, and you're going to have to obey God. And when you obey God, even though you don't understand, suddenly you've got the wisdom of the ages. It's great when you have wisdom and insight, and you do it because you know, wow, if I do this, I see it. Wonderful, motivating thing. You know, but it's equal that if you just simply obey God, even though you don't see it or don't understand it, it's equal to having the wisdom and the insight that says, oh, I understand. If I do this, what's going to happen? Just obey God. The Lord says, you have not, for you ask not. And then he tells us exactly what he wants in terms of the asking. He tells us about what kind of prayer that he's wanting us to bring before him. So I want you, I want you to keep up with me. And I don't want you to forget. I want you to remember. Look at Psalms chapter 2, verse 9. Look how easy that is. Or it's 2, it's 8, isn't it? Psalms 2, verse 8. Go look, turn in your pages. Go look. People, if you don't allow God to birth in your heart through fellowship with him, the things that are in his heart, you'll never do what he's called you to do or purposed you to do. And you'll wander around trying to figure out what's wrong with you, trying to fix yourself, and you'll find that there is no cure for you. That you don't have the remedy. But if you would just simply begin to do what God has assigned for you to do, if you just come where he's called you to come, all of a sudden, everything would begin to change. And we begin to see, once again in the church, people of maturity, people who know how to lay hold on God, people who know how to flow in the gifts of the Spirit, people who know how to flow in the realms of compassion. Wow, I mean, that's a rare thing. To see people who have the compassion of Jesus, who love on that level, who's so concerned and caring. Are you listening to me? That they're going to go and pick up the person right now who's been wanting to come to church for a month and a half and has had no ride. And still nobody can go pick him up. Bernie, I hope you're watching. Somebody's going to come and get you. I'll do it if it doesn't work out any other way. But you know, there's thousands of Bernies right now in San Diego, California. But there's very few people moved with compassion. And besides that, we know you're busy. I understand. There's a lot of things going on in your life. You're consumed with other interests. But what's going to happen is if you'll come and stand before his presence, everything that is earthly will grow strangely dim, and all those other interests that supposedly is keeping you from what God's purposed you to do will suddenly disappear and fade away. And it's not going to happen any other way, people. I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to find hunger from pulling your hair out. You're not going to find thirsting because somehow you did some kind of human exercise. You're going to find hunger because all of a sudden you recognize how numb and how full you are. Because you're not hungry when you're full. Then you have to ask yourself, what are you full of? You know what? Are you full of everything that is producing the outworking, the ministry of Jesus? That means you're going to be what he said. He said, oh, you won't be barren and unfruitful. If you'll just do these things, if you'll do what I'm telling you to do, you won't be barren and unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord. And when we're talking about fruitfulness in the knowledge of the Lord, we're talking about spirit knowledge, and we're seeing the fruitfulness of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're seeing the fruitfulness of Paul's ministry and Peter's ministry and the church ministry of what he's called us to be. We know that God wants fruit. He said to Israel, I'm taking the kingdom from you, and I'm going to give it to a nation that bring forth the fruits, the outworking of it. Dear people, the Lord took the fruits and the outworking of it all to a whole nother level when the New Covenant Church was born. I mean, it's a whole nother dimension of what God had called Israel as a nation to do. Now it's not just the activities of walking out a relationship of purity and a lifestyle and a nature that's pleasing unto God, but now it's the demonstration of the power and the glory of heaven. It's not just Father's midst seen in our midst. Father's glory seen in our midst. It's his outworking and his presence seen in our life. There's too many people that are willing to go ahead and continue on living their life without that. They want to just deal with anecdotes. They want to say, well, there was a certain time in one place, I think somebody got healed. Big deal. I mean, I wouldn't even brag about that if I were you. I would be a little bit more ashamed about that. I mean, you know, we're going to have to recognize that all of our anecdotes, all of the things that we, our anecdotal supposed examples of how we have this great fruitfulness in God is going to become irrelevant. And we've got to go to another standard. A continual glorious flow of divine expression of the power of God. That's not going to come because you showed up to church and you were faithful to church and you said in the meeting, and you can quote Bible verses of scripture. But something begins to happen in your life where the Holy Ghost begins to find a realm of being able to flow through you. A fire has got to touch you from heaven. When a fire touches you from heaven, all of a sudden a hunger and a passion begins to spring up that will cause everything of this world to grow strangely dim. And that's one of the things about fasting. You'll begin to quickly prioritize when you're fasting and prayer. I mean, in fasting and prayer, when it's really fasting and prayer, you lose a lot of the interest that normally you'll just sit there and feast on, like Twinkies and pom-poms or whatever they're called, ding-dongs or whatever. You got to be a ding-dong to eat it, right? At any rate, all the garbage and all the junk food that people take into their spirit. You know, it's like I was imagining people to be like TV heads, library heads, because that's where they're at. That's where their mind's at. You know, they got a school book head. How about having a Christ Jesus head? How about having a Spirit of God head? How about having a Word of God head? Not a Word of God that just says, oh, I know all the Bible and I know all the theology and I know all the doctrines. No, but a Word of God, the mind and thinking that causes you so desperately to want to have all that Christ Jesus described and purpose for us to have. People, hello. Just receive right now. Just be filled right now. Slow response, hey. Very slow. Very slow response, isn't it? It is. It's a slow response. It's a slow response. You know why? Can I tell you why? You're filled with the earth. You're filled with the earth. You've been doing earth all day. You've been doing your jobs. You've been consumed with the thinking of all the stuff that you've got to get done and that you're required to do. And somebody said, is there another way for me to do my job? Yes, there is. There is another way for you to live your life. There's another way for you to live out this wonderful realm of heaven. And the first thing is that you're going to have to begin to deal with the reality of what's going on in your life in relationship to what Father's called you to be. You know what Father called you to be? Called you to be a new creation. He called you to be a new creation, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, with rivers of his divine expression flowing out of you continually. Somebody said, how do I pray without ceasing? Rivers flowing out of you in your most being. Unless you got some big valve somewhere that you turn it on and off with. And I say that that's not the salvation that Jesus described. And I say that's not the baptism of the Holy Ghost that he gives. And I say that you, I understand, I'm telling you, dear people, everybody wants to point a finger and say those folks across the street don't got it right. Well, maybe you ought to recognize that maybe you don't have it right. Maybe there's serious adjustments that need to be made in your life. But reality of it is, I don't see where anybody's going to be that honest. So I'm going to just go ahead and take it back over to another level of just saying, look at what the Word of God describes and ask yourself, is that going on in your life? And then say, if it's not going on in your life, then you got to say, well, what has the Lord asked me to do that I've not been willing to do? Because he said, those that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Huh? And I know exactly what he's talking about in terms of righteousness. I know that he's talking about his character. I'm telling you right now, compassion is front and center of that. A love for people's lost soul. I'm not talking about a generosity and a kindness. I'm talking about a love for people's souls that does not want to see them wake up in an eternity without God. The Lord makes it very simple here in Psalms 2, verse 8. He says, ask of me and I will give you the heathen. Ask of me and I'll give you the lost. But reality, and he says, ask of me, I'll give you the lost. I'll give you the uttermost parts of the world. I'll give you the uttermost parts of the earth for your possession. Somebody said, oh, well, that's what the psalmist was describing concerning Jesus. But you don't understand. We're in Christ Jesus. He's in us. Our life is supposed to be all about his life. Somewhere, sometime, someplace, somebody is going to have to believe that their life has come to an end and that they are a living sacrifice, living out the very life of Christ Jesus right now, bearing out his life, and that their whole purpose of being is not to make money, not to pay for a mortgage, not to take care of another car payment, not to deal with all the other earthly interests that everybody's so high on, to have another success, to have another attaboy, another pat on the back, another promotion, another whatever. Another praise of men. Because the Lord says, if you're seeking the praises of men and that's what you're living off of, you're not right with him. That's what he tells us. And so we want to say, well, where's our hearts at? Is our hearts passionate about seeing the lost come in? Is our hearts passionate about showing first and foremost, showing people compassion and showing them the compassion and the love of God? It's not even possible without the flow of the Holy Ghost. Not even possible to have that until you really know how to stand in his presence and begin to interact with him in a way that he's fashioned for us to interact with him. Because remember, he's looking, God the Father is looking for people who know how to interact with him by the Holy Ghost and truth. He's not looking for all the other stuff. Father's looking for some people who's willing to allow the Holy Spirit to have free course in their life where they begin to pray and literally everything about their life begins to change in that context. And you know, on this past Friday night, we had a School of the Spirit, and I just wanted to tell people about how they're able to hook up with God through just the quoting of the Word, how that there is a way to hook up with the manifest presence of God to literally feel the surge of his divine life. People, I know this for certain. Many, maybe the majority of people in the church community today have never experienced the rivers of God flowing through their life. They've never experienced the rivers of God. Maybe there is another group of people that from time to time they experience the rivers of God. And they are a proverbial example of a New Testament person who, as it were, has the Holy Ghost coming upon them and lifting off. You know, because how else would you describe it? Reality of it is that the Holy Spirit has come to live and abide on the inside of us. The Spirit of Son is here. But he isn't going to take over and move past our will and our participation. That is going to be developed, that is going to intensify, and that is going to grow as we give ourselves to prayer. I believe that if people believe that, that there would be an increase in the manifest presence of God, an increase in the manner in which they are able to function and move in the life and the anointing of God, that they would give themselves all day to prayer. Or if they didn't give themselves all day to prayer, they would give themselves a whole lot more to prayer. But I don't believe that people really believe it. They're still in the humdrum boredom of prayer. They don't know how to move past listening to the sound of their own voice. And some people don't even have a sound of their own voice when they're praying. It's all telepathy. It's all something that is just a silent whatever. And that's not talking to God. I mean, Father wants to take you to a place where you have a conversation. You listen to me. I've watched this work over and again in this church and churches all around where you call people to prayer and they're just all like feeling like somebody just gave them a little scolding. But then as soon as you dismiss and they're just normally casually talking to people, the place becomes a roar. I often thought, my Father, I'm so sorry. First of all, please forgive us. Father, if we were talking to you like this with such relaxing and enjoyment and passion and enthusiasm, we would have already changed the world. So please forgive us. Forgive us that we don't know how to talk to you like this, and that we're not excited to talk to you like this, and that you're not as real to us as the person that we're looking at, which really just seems to inspire and pull out of us all this conversation about the stupidest stuff sometimes too, right? Oh man, did you get stuck in traffic yesterday? Yeah, it was unbelievable traffic. Did you see what happened in that traffic? My goodness. And they're just on and on and on and on and on and on and on. And they got this passion and this emotion and this inspiring. And they like, they never tire. I'm honestly, I've sat back just looking at this, just going, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. People have no idea. What's Pastor upset about? Hey, the preacher looks a little anxious. I wonder what's wrong with him. Why? Because I'm going over there, wait a minute, man. Why hasn't this ever taken? Why have people not moved from the realm of the purely human into the purely spiritual? Why hasn't the transition taken place when we've been given the opportunity to have far more than Moses and Samuel had? But look at what Moses and Samuel did with what they had. It might have taken Moses a while to come into these things, but you know, he was always serious and passionate. But once heaven touched him, he didn't receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but he had an encounter with the baptizer. Yes. Huh? He would be very close to being baptized in the Holy Ghost. I mean, when you're so overwhelmed by the glory of God, your face begins to shine. People, I have witnessed in my life, I have witnessed as a child, I have even witnessed in later years, not even too long ago, being around in circumstances where everybody pretty much in the room, their face was shining. Because the anointing of the Holy Ghost was so rich. And it had been all day. I mean, we had been just in the things of the fellowship of the Word and in prayer and just walking. No carnal, no earthly, no natural subject, thought, thinking, discussion ever even beckoned our life that day. But there's a realm to live in. There's a whole lot better things to talk about than what you've been talking about. You better watch out how much you give yourself to the gift of gab, because I'm going to tell you right now, Father says you're going to give account for every foolish and jestful thing you say. How about the serious things that you say? Oh, Father, aren't you really interested in my subject of mechanics? No, I'm really not. Oh, Father, aren't you really interested in my subject of biochemistry? No, it has no earthly, has no heavenly value. Oh, but I've got to talk biochemistry. No, you don't. You could talk Jesus. You just want to talk biochemistry. Oh, but I've got to talk these things. No, you don't. No, you could constantly rearrange it. A man of God was telling me one day, and everything he did in his business, he just made it about Jesus. Everything. It was a deal. He was getting ready to close the deal. He wanted to close in prayer. He wanted to talk about a deal. We're going to open and talk about Jesus. Are you born again? Do you know Christ Jesus? So it's always about that. One day, He was in a hurry. He had to go to a meeting. It was a meeting that was and it spoke volumes to me. It was a meeting that was extremely profitable for him. Lots of money involved. He was late already. Guy showed up. He said, listen, I don't have time right now. I'll be back in 2 hours. You know, come back and I'll spend some time. He gets down the road, about 5 minutes down the road, and the Lord says, oh, really? Is this the way you're going to treat me? Is this the way you're going to treat that man's soul? He immediately slammed on his brakes, turned around, came flying back, caught the guy before he left. I don't know that most of God's people are even that sensitive to his will. We're so hell-bent or earthly bent on doing whatever it is we got to do. Because we've so justified it. We've so written it in the books of life and said, God, let me erase all the stuff that you want there, because you know what? This is the way it's got to go right here. Look, okay? Got that? Read. And we've done it. We've not done it with that kind, obviously, of high-handed arrogance. But people, we've done it indeed. Maybe we've not done it by word, and I hope we haven't done it by word or by conscious thinking. But it's unconscious thinking lives that causes us to realize that we need to awake from our sleep, which is really just all about at best it's a sleeping church, but by definition it's a backslidden one. Somehow we're going to have to move past what we're stuck in. Somehow you're going to have a reevaluation of what's important to you, hopefully before you get to be 76. Because then there's not much you can do. You're living on some, my goodness, there's no way you can really move into signs and wonders and miracles in this dispensation of time, because by and large, when people are 76, they're basically on their deathbed. I mean, when Moses was 80, it would be probably like being 35 now. Are you with me? It'd probably be like being 35 when he's 80. He lived to 120. He was doing great. His eyesight never dimmed. He had a lot of vitality. Look at what he was able to do. He walked across the desert. I mean, come on, that's not an old guy. He walked up the mountain. He fasted for 80 days without food or water. There's a place called the spiritual. There's a place called the spirit, the realms of the spirit. If you're coming, if you come and you're less than moving in the Holy Ghost, you're just in another religion. Because only the Holy Ghost brings life and embodiment to those things which God has declared. Only it's just the word speaking until the Holy Spirit starts moving, because then he brings forth the actual life and power and glory of it. And people, it's really about your relationship. I'm talking to you about your willingness to come and ask God. I watch where people, hey, I love the heavenly language. The heavenly language is a springboard for me to begin to ask Father more specifically things out of the realms of the Spirit by my understanding. I'm not just walking around praying in the Holy Ghost. I see people just praying in the Holy Ghost. You're not asking yet. You're not asking. You have not because you ask not. Sometimes I wonder what's going on here with this program. I mean, this is supposed to be bringing us into a place of spirit knowledge. If I come to you speaking in the heavenly realm, what does it profit you unless I speak by knowledge, by revelation, by doctrine, by prophecy? But listen, people, it really has a similar impact upon you personally and who you are and what value you have in the kingdom of God. Look at Moses' value. He was able to intercede on behalf of the people. He was able to bring down the miracle power of heaven. He was able to change nations. He was able to change the circumstance and the situation that opposed the people of God. He was able to impact a generation that nobody's gotten over from since. So was Samuel. So was John Praying Hind. And he only lived to be 47 years old. John Hind did more with his life, living only to 47 years, than the vast majority of God's people will ever do, living to be 80. It's just wrong. Why must a few do the work of the many? Why, when God has not left it in a caste system, he's not left it. I mean, if the Lord was only going to anoint and put his favor and grace upon a few and allow a few to actually have access to him into the holies of holies. I mean, I talked to you on Sunday about the fact that the priests are anointed to stand before God, and I'm not sure that anybody even heard what I said. I mean, you heard what I said, but you didn't hear what I said. That an anointing has been given to us so that we can stand in the presence of the Lord and that we can actually interact with Father, that we can come before him, have an audience with him. I believe we start asking Father for certain things, and he looks at us and he's waiting for truth. I believe that maybe even there's a possibility that God is hearing something that's coming out of our lips by the Spirit of the Son, the Holy Ghost, but he's waiting for truth. What is truth going to do? It's going to be a practical change of life. There's going to be a practical change of a heart. I mean, it's just like with little children. Let me just tell you. You know, I know about management of little kids. I understand that there's some basic rules to this. You take a wild animal, and I can take a wild animal, and I can break that wild animal by and large without ever having too much harassment, because I'll take him out of the wild, wide open field where he can just go do whatever he wants to and run free, and I will put him in a small 4x8 pen that's about 6 foot high. And it's going to be really hectic to start with. We usually open it up just a little bit, actually. That's where it ends up. I start off right about 12 by 12, otherwise he's going to break his neck. 12 by 12, he's going to run around there. At least he's got some room to get energy out. Otherwise, he's going to be jumping straight up and down. But I just keep getting it smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. And I bring it down to something that's just really about 4x8. And then they just can stand there and just leave him there. Make sure he's got plenty of food. Make sure he's got plenty of water. You take all of this wild freedom of choice away from him. And suddenly, now he's listening. Yet Father doesn't, I mean, that will help with children. You can actually have, you know what? It's better than math class, obedience class. 1 hour a day, children, obedience class. What's that going to mean? That means mom and dad, you're going to have to pay attention. You're going to have to stop doing whatever it is that you're wanting to do and have an obedience class 1 hour a day, every day. It won't take long and everything's changed. But you say, well, I do that. No, I don't know that you do, maybe because what happens is somebody starts talking and then we spin it in our own mind to make it what it is that we think that they're saying. No, I'm talking about focused obedience class. It's about learning to obey and doing certain things and exercises that are one. It's compacted in 1 hour a day. It doesn't take long, and things will be changed. Listen, well, you know what? We need that in our lives with the Lord individually. And, you know, I think that the Lord does it in an amazing way where he takes us and he wrings us away from all of our other activities and all the other things that we can wildly go run and do and says, I want you to come over here and I want you to get quiet before me and I want you to spend time with me. I want you to sit right here and I want you to begin to study my word because I want to begin to talk to you. And we say, okay, Lord, I've been going for 5 minutes. I haven't heard anything yet. No, he was talking about 5 years. He may have been talking about 15 years. He may have been just talking about 5 hours, because it really depends. I know sometimes it's really not the length of the prayer, it's the depth of it. It's how passionate is it, how deep is it, how real is it, how stirring, how demanding is it, how full of boldness and confidence and intensity is it. And it's not in the intensity, not so much of your voice and your physical demeanor. It's about something that comes out of the realm of that which only the Holy Ghost supplies. And that's going to have to grow in your life. You can't have a full-grown adult warrior Holy Ghost, manifestation, you know, when you're still just a little baby in the spirit. Somebody said there's no junior Holy Ghost. Well, yeah, there is. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I'm looking at it. Oh, everywhere I go, you know, I'm looking at junior Holy Ghost everywhere. Huh? And what do I mean by that? I mean because there's not been a development of our spirit with his spirit, because he's not going to bypass our spirit. He's going to do with us, he's going to do through us what we are willing and agreeing to do with him, and that this is something that is not born out of anything other than love interaction, romance interaction, relationship interaction. It's not, you know, it's not faith when you're sitting there going, That is, you know, and that's not even Gethsemane. And macho people's spirit sometimes can be that, or just holler, whatever. It's faith when it's got a consistency of recognizing, it's got an impact of recognizing, a feel of recognizing and interacting with Holy Spirit, knowing that he's here. That's faith. It's seeing him, it's feeling him, it's experiencing his presence. Yeah, there may be in case you're watching me right now by the web, and I know certain things are happening across the United States right now, and hey, I have no problem with the agony of Gethsemane, but you're going to have Pentecostal joy soon. Amen. Yeah. Soon. Yeah. Soon. Soon. Please, within 50 days, please. 50? 55? Please. Okay, but fine. You know, yes, and I understand that the Lord will put a burden upon a people to begin to weep between the porch and the altar over the state of the situation in our families and in our communities and in our nation and in the nations of the earth, and especially within the framework of the church. I'm happy about any manifestation of the Holy Ghost because I've been looking for one. I'm looking for something that looks like a move of God that has Father's affections in it, matured affections in it, the intercessions of the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, prayer's a good thing. Otherwise, he wouldn't be forever living to do it. I mean, he's made it number one thing. We don't even understand it. I mean, I've been dealing with people for years that I can still see they don't understand prayer. And I know why. You preoccupied with other things. You preoccupied. You fitting God into your life. It's time for you to start fitting you in until you can't fit yourself anymore in. You know what? I've been fitting you in for quite a while, Mark, but you know what? I'm sorry. I'm moving on. I just really don't have any more time for you. I'm moving on. Come on. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. Right now, our planner is filled with us, and we're trying to work God in 30 minutes a day. Well, Lord, you know what? We need to average this out because I made a plan on Sundays. I'm in church like about, 5-6 hours on Sundays and, roughly 3 hours on Wednesday. And so when you kind of do the math, it's about 8 to 9 hours. And, I think that I should include driving time. So let's go ahead and 10, 11 hours. So, if I average that over 7 days, I'm giving you at least, I'm not giving you a tithe, but you know what? I'm doing better than most people are. I'm in there about an hour. You know what? That is crazy, isn't it? It's crazy thinking. And I don't think that any, I'm sure that I didn't say that because that is a thing that anyone thinks in here. I was just saying that to make a point about how we might go about somehow escaping our responsibility and not making God first. I'm going to tell you right now, you've got to evaluate, have you made God first or have you made him last? Because I've watched a lot of people do things at the last minute. That means God's last. I watch a lot of people defer what God has gave them assignments to do. That's making God last. Oh, I just didn't work. Didn't work. Why? Well, I only had one person showing up. Well, do you know how long Reinhard Bonnke had one person showing up? Do you know how long Amy Simple McPherson had one person showing up? Do you know how long Mariah Wordworth Etter had one person showing up? You know what there was difference between you and them? They didn't stop. They had a hold of heaven. You did. You must have not. Something was wrong. So, what you've got to find is, really, you've got to find, you've got to find an assignment from heaven. And that assignment comes to us right from the Word of God. And an assignment is a general assignment. It's not unique for each individual person. People said, I don't feel a call to prayer. That's nonsense. Everyone's called to prayer. You don't feel to obey and respond to prayer. Why don't you say it like it really is? Because the Bible's very clear on it. Everybody's called to prayer with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost, watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Yeah. Hallelujah. And guess what you're supposed to do when you're praying? You're supposed to have what? Holy Ghost prayer. And what is the Holy Ghost doing? Is he now melancholy and sorrowful and depressed and mourning and, No, he's not. No, he's not. There is going to be boldness. There is going to be faith. There is going to be intensity. There is going to be zeal. There's going to be joy. There's going to be the love. There's going to be the compassion. There's also going to be the temperance. There's going to be the long-suffering and the enduring prayer that goes on in our lives. Look with me quickly and just help you understand this in Luke chapter 11. Because people, if you don't do this, shame upon you. Shame upon you. Shame upon you. Because the reality of it is you have reduced the love and the grace and the mercy of God to be of very little value in your life. If you're not willing to step up into a relationship, I can't help it you don't know the beauty and the splendor and the glory of the relationship. Obey God. Start being consistent with God, and you're going to discover you're going to hit gold. You're going to hit something better than gold, man. What happens is all of a sudden you're digging and digging. I know how tiring it can get and be digging and digging and digging. And this is a bad allegory, but I'm going to give it because it ain't this way with prayer. But you're digging and digging and digging and coming up with nothing. And all of a sudden you hit the vein for silver. And when you hit the vein for silver, I don't care how tired and worn out you are. You excited, you motivated, because that vein keeps getting just a little bit thicker, a little bit taller, a little bit bolder. And all of a sudden you're into the chips, God, the Holy Spirit, comes upon us and overwhelms us with his presence and with his divine glory. People, there is a place of communion with God that you can find that is so valuable you'd rather be thrown to the lions than to be without it. There's something that people have come to understand, an intimacy with God, an interaction with God that caused Moses to say, lest you go with me, I'm not interested in no land of milk and honey. I'm not interested in a land of great riches and wealth. I'll stay right here on this bare rock of a mountain unless you're going to go with me. I found something in the divine glory. Listen to me, until this is a reality in your life, you only have religion. And the Hindu religion is no different from the Christian religion. Christian religion is no different from the Hindu religion. They just got different names. And people are shocked to hear me say that, but you listen to me, it's true. Because you're never going to please God without the Holy Ghost. Jesus Christ died for you and I to be filled with the Holy Ghost. That's it. That's the Word of God, to be filled with the life of the Spirit. And when you have the life of the Spirit, you've got a different demeanor. It's a different demeanor. When you've been born of God, it's a different demeanor. Hello. Come on, people. Come on, people. There's something going on within your life that is heavenly, that is glorious, that is God power, that goes beyond the human framework. It isn't, excuses like I'm sick and tired. You should be sick and tired, but sick and tired of yourself. But in other words, sick and tired and busy and preoccupied, those are things that have no meaning and no value within the framework of what the Holy Ghost is doing, because he brings heaven into our life. The river of God begins to flow, and there is fresh oil. And there is, hallelujah. There is refreshing there. Hallelujah. There is renewing there. Hallelujah. There is strength there. Faith. You know, faith is what makes the difference of it just being another activity that that is going to be something almost like the repetition of phrases, or just a repetition of what happened before and the results. Faith knows that Father hears. Faith knows that Father hears what we're saying, that Father is moving and working on our behalf. Faith, therefore, has a persistence to it. It has an interaction to it. It has an enjoyment in the process as we ask Father for the nations. Listen, there's no reason for this church to go on as it is with the numbers that it has when there's so many people out there to reach. What's going to change it? What's going to change it? What's going to change it? What's going to change it is somebody's got to take their car and go get somebody. But what's going to make you change to be willing to do that and prioritize God's things over yourself? Prayer. But prayer that has a relationship attribute to it. In fact, that it's just all about relationship and not just an attribute. It's about interacting with Him. And that's supposed to be fullness of joy and pleasure forevermore. Oh, it's okay to sing about it and, you know, try to get into it. You're trying your best to move with the crowd, and you don't feel it, but, you know, we're going to just try our best. Something needs to happen in your life. Because when you die and you breathe out your last breath, you can be trying your best all you want, but whatever you are is going to be fully revealed. Whatever you are is supposed to be fully revealed right now by the power of the Holy Ghost. And if what's going on in your life don't look like the Holy Ghost and doesn't result in the obedience of Jesus Christ, I'd get hungry and get desperate and get real with God and say, wait a minute, Father, I want you to shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul. I want to make adjustments in my life. I don't want to continue going on making excuses for myself and self-justifying, only ultimately to drift and become that much harder. Instead of hard of hearing, that much more dull of hearing. A state of reoccurring sin is a lost state. It's a lost state. You hear me now? You get over yourself. You get over the things of where you've been more in league with the powers of darkness than God. I'm telling you, Father's right there. He'll answer. He's quick to hear. His ears are open unto the prayers of the righteous. His face is against those that do wickedness, that sin. The beautiful thing is, his Father's got an instant cure for sin and wickedness, doesn't he? Praise God for the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. You lay hold on the blood of Jesus, and now you can come with all boldness into the holies of holies. I find myself coming into with all boldness in the holies of holies all the time, because that's the only way that we come in anyway. And the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all sin if you confess your sin, if you'll come clean with God. I'm earnest for you. Look, you have to understand, if I've been all day in a passionate, Holy Ghost, fiery move of God, and then I come into a place where I'm communing where it's less, you have to understand. I mean, for you, this may be the height of the move of God in your life today, and I've got to try to understand. But really, what we want to come to is a place where we're so on fire with the glory of God that the passion in heaven, the passion of heaven and the flow of the Holy Ghost has overwhelmed us, where the things of spirit knowledge is easy for us to entreat and receive and begin to move in. Hallelujah. Look at the state of the hunger that Cornelius' house was in. Look at the state of hunger that his house was in. The way his heart was prepared to seek the Lord. And by and large, when we talk about our heart being prepared to seek the Lord, we're talking about our heart prepared to receive too. Oh God. Well, listen. I'm not going to tell you what the problem is. I'm going to tell you what the answer is. I'm not going to tell you what's holding you back. I'm going to tell you what can promote you. I'm going to tell you that you're going to have to stop doing what you're doing. You're going to have to come and set an hour of prayer aside, an hour of prayer aside, an hour a day of prayer. You're going to have to set it aside, and you're going to have to begin to talk with Father. I'm talking about an hour a day. I'm just going to lay it out there for you. Somebody said, can it be 30 minutes? Well, if you are that intimidated by His presence, yes. If you're that intimidated by His presence. Huh? What I would even say better than that, here's what I would say. When you're overwhelmed by the manifest presence of God, you know your prayer has been received in heaven. And the answer has come. Then stop then. And I'm going to tell you right now, until you learn how to touch heaven with your prayer, we find this state throughout the Pentecostal church. It's not just in one little isolated place. What am I talking to you about? We can talk about revival. We can all jump up and down and praise God. Oh, God, send revival, send the rain. We can talk about His presence like a fire. We can get all excited about these things. And then just go on home and then just say, woo, 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 woo. Great meeting. Woo. Great meeting. Great meeting. Or we can recognize what needs to happen in our lives individually, if there is going to be a change in the earth, if there is going to be a moving forward. San Diego, come on, tell me, how many people are in San Diego? How many people are in San Diego? How many of you know how many people are in San Diego because you bring the numbers before the Lord in prayer? So I want to help you here. I want to help you. Can I help you? Will you let me help you?
Yes.
If you were to die tonight, your life was coming to an end. What do you have to live on forever, for eternity? What do you have to bring before the throne? Right now. You do the tally. You do the math. Let me see your books. Because I know you're concerned about your books financially right now for what you're going to have when you retire in a time that you're imagining for yourself that you don't even know you have. I know many people who died making a fortune to do something great in the kingdom, and they died. And their money was turned over to the heathen. Are you with me? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
So you got to do the books. You've got to evaluate your life. You need to do the books. Somebody says, oh, you know, I'm just saved by grace. Amen, you are. But not by any works of righteousness which I've done. Amen, you are. It's just all on Jesus. Yeah, that's true. And so you're going to come empty-handed. That's not very honorable. That's not very appreciative. Huh? God gave us the gift of righteousness and holiness, and the covenant was that we were willing to walk in it and learn to walk in it. God gave us the Holy Ghost and power so that we can go about everywhere showing people the love of God, first in action and deed, and then by demonstration of the power. What, how is a demonstration of the power? Because I'm showing them love and kindness and the things that I'm saying and things that I'm doing. But then all of a sudden, I recognize, wait a minute, they've got a crippling disease. Oh, guess what? I'm going to get to love you and let you see God's love on another higher level. Be healed in Jesus' name. But what goes on is if you try to do this outside of relationship, relationship is going to produce an overwhelming flood of love. Relationship is going to produce an overflowing realm of glory. You know what I think I should do? I think I should reorganize this group. I think I should put the people that are sitting aloof from what God's doing on the front row and take everybody who's plugged in off the front row and put them back there in the back rows. I'm thinking about doing that right now. I know the spiritual dynamic of what's going on, but worse, Father knows. I know what's going on in people's lives and hearts right now and the response, but worse, Father knows. Not worse for me, worse for you. If that isn't a passionate receptivity towards what God has purposed to do. Because you know why people get sad and upset? Because when I start talking about these things, it demands that they've got to reorganize their life. And God's been talking to some of you about reorganizing your life for a long time, and you keep putting them off. You keep putting them off. You keep putting them off. And I tell you, it's not going to work out well for you. It's time to make Christ Jesus your ruler and put the things of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God first. It's time to step out and begin to trust God like Jesus described in Matthew chapter 6. It's time. It's time. It's time to say, okay, make yourself available. Take all that you have. And if you're not going to sell it and give it to the poor, then why don't you take all that you have and make it available to the church, like your car to go pick people up, huh? About your life and your time to go out and minister the things of the Spirit. On some level, there's too many kids. There's too many children in this city to go get. There's too many kids that are at home alone at between 4 years old and 12 years old. And nobody's moving. The harvest is plenteous. Why aren't... You know, I believe that if you would begin to say, and just if you were praying nothing more than this prayer and saying, Lord of the harvest, raise up laborers, because that's what Jesus said to pray. You know, if you would just start praying the prayers that Jesus said to pray to start with, things would begin to change. And you're just like, you're talking to Father, and maybe it can't go any further than this. Maybe it's just, Lord, make me hungry. Lord, I'm not hungry. I recognize I'm not hungry. I'm so filled with the earthly things, I don't have any room for the spiritual. Lord, I want to become hungry. Show me how to walk in hunger. Lord, I thank you that you're listening to me. I thank you that what you said, that I have not because I ask not, and I'm asking. And I'm not asking something that is just a miss. I'm asking you to do something in my life, oh God, that I can't do for myself, because you can't find any. You can't find hunger from any other place but the Holy Ghost. And Father has made it possible. It just as much as he's given every man the gift of faith, there's the gift of hunger. Hallelujah. But what happens if you don't feed the hunger with the things of the Spirit? You got Father touches you. He touches you. You have a prayer meeting. You feel the presence of God. Pastor, it's amazing. You're right. I went in. By the end of the week, I was feeling the presence of God. I was walking. I walked in my own home, falling out on the anointing. Because it was prayer time. And no, it does come to that. Just getting near the bed or something, cush, because I'm going down. He just gets that good. But then, you know, I've got to go on a work trip, and, you know, we've got meetings every day. And so, you know, then all of a sudden you get distracted, and it's going away. And now you're back to the same old place. You're back to the same place. You're on a merry-go-round. Huh? You're one step forward, two steps back. Or maybe two steps forward, praise God, and only one and a half steps back. And that's at least you're getting a half step. And so we're getting nowhere. I mean, just did you go for a walk that way? Go for a walk tomorrow. Go two steps. And then go back a step and a half. Okay? Then go two steps. And then go back a step and a half step. And then go two steps, and then go back a step and a half step. And see how long it takes you to go around that 1 mile track. And let it be a spiritual witness to you. And so ask yourself, is this really how you want to do it? Huh? Get on the mile track and go down on your hands and knees and crawl around the thing. And ask yourself, is that how you want to do it? Is this how you want to move forward in God? Because the Lord... Christ Jesus has called us to a place of asking, seeking, and knocking. He demands it. He demands it. He didn't say, look, you know what? No problem, guys. I've got a quick in and out service. And if I don't get you your answered prayer in 5 seconds, you're going to get an extra one on me. In fact, if I don't get your, I tell you right now, if I don't get your prayer answered to you in 5 seconds, I'm going to give you bonus points. That's you. That's you. That ain't has nothing to do with the anointing in the place. That's your response to the Holy Ghost. Smile. Everybody smile in this place right now. You're going to get me so upset that I'm going to come and smack you probably. You just smile, get a smile on your face. I'm going to tell you right now, you have no right to reproach God. Sitting there with all a frowny look because I'm telling you, you got to change. Because I'm telling you, you're not doing it right. And God demands it. And you're going to have to obey. And not play around with God. Period. You know, if I got to be in a small church, there's going to be a fiery Holy Ghost one with a bunch of people obedient. I'm going to sit around a bunch of sour-looking faces. I'm going to go to the ends of the earth somewhere. Give me a break. Hello. I'm about ready to move some of you up to the front row right now. I'm about ready to call you out. I'm not kidding you. Get ready. I'll make a special row for you right up here facing everybody. Melancholy is a demon oppressive spirit. Melancholy, depression, it is a thing brought by an evil spirit. You run it off. Don't you allow it. Sit there and fellowship with something that's right out of the realm of darkness. Huh? Get yourself over in a fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Huh? Get yourself over in a fellowship. And if you wouldn't just have like 10 minutes of joy a day. 5 minutes of peace. Huh? 6.5 minutes of love. Huh? And 3 seconds of compassion. Huh? 1.5 minutes of goodness. And the rest is hell. Disruption, confusion, overwhelmed. How are you listening to me? Yes. Hello! Yes. Step into good things of God. I mean, Father allows misrepresentation for just so long. It's true. True. Josiah brought a great revival, but God still said by his prophet, now, I shall remove Judah out of my presence and out of my face, even as I did Israel. And I shall remove the city from which... in this place, in this temple, from where I had decided to put my name. And it shall be no more. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 27. Because the Father's not going to allow misrepresentation for just so long. Let's just grab a hold of a place of seeking God until the Holy Ghost comes.
Yes. Amen.
I mean, I don't think that necessarily all of those people in the holiness movement had it all right, but there's one thing that they had right. Let's pray till the glory comes. Amen. And let's not stop praying until the atmosphere changes, till the glory comes, till we're overwhelmed with the glory and the fire of God is welling up in the inside of us, because we know what's going to happen as soon as that takes place. We're going to be so excited about the things of God, so beside ourselves, and so over into another realm of consciousness of heaven, we're going to go reach the lost. We're going to go give witness to the resurrection. Huh? We're going to move in the glory of God. And then all of a sudden somebody found out, wait a minute, you mean to tell me that you can live like this all the time? Yeah, but you're going to have to learn how to be continually filled with the Spirit. Amen. Do you know how many people know how to be continually filled with the Spirit? Not many people. And when you learn how to be continually filled with the Spirit, you're ruined. You probably won't be able to work your job anymore. In fact, if it is, when you learn how to be continually filled with the Spirit, you have great need. God has great need of you, and there's great use for you. There's going to be doors open for you all over the place. You're going to be busy in the things of the kingdom on a full-time basis. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's right. That's right. That's right. They're going to be, if you don't have a place to preach in, they're going to be at your doorstep. They're going to be knocking on your door. They're going to be coming over at all hours of the night. We're looking for, calling you up, saying, look, I'm looking for somebody who knows how who knows how to pray, who has power with God, come touch me. That should be said of every person in this place. That should be said of every person in this place. Instead of you calling out people all hours of the night, having them come pray for you. It should be said of every person in this place. People want just a bunch of hype and circumstance. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have to get down on your knees and work out the things and the issues in your life that are not right with God to start with. And that's messy. And you can have some tears and some Gethsemane there. But once you break through that, I'm going to tell you right now, you can begin to move in the faith and the passion of the living God, and you come to understand that there are things that are worked out in the continual asking, and there's things that are worked out in the continual seeking, and there's things that are worked out in the continual knocking, and there's things that are worked out where you persistently come before the Lord, and you come to realize why men ought to always pray and not to faint. Yes, you do. Yeah, you do. Because, and what happens, you don't get discouraged, because discouragement's the realm of doubt. And in this place where you're moved by the Holy Ghost to praying without ceasing, this kind of praying, who I'm in, not to always pray, not to faint, it's Holy Ghost moved prayer. What's happening is you've got faith in the midst of that Holy Ghost prayer. And so there is no possibility for discouragement. Hallelujah. You just come, okay, where were we at yesterday, Lord? Okay, well, where were we at this morning? Okay, I'll pick it right back up there. Oh, yeah, I remember. Okay, Father, I just thank you right now. And you're just take right off with it. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. Ha, ha. Hallelujah. Ha, ha. Ramandas de keste. Ha, ha. Ramandas se pretaya. Ha, ha. You know, I had Chris telling me how he wanted to have Bible study and tell people about God's original thoughts and what he did before he ever created anything, and what was in his mind before he did it all, and all the other rest of that stuff. I said, no, you need to talk about salvation and the Holy Ghost till you get it. You need to, none of the unfolding the secret mysteries of the divine glory, the things that God doesn't even know about. I mean, how about just understanding what is the principles of why on earth, why in heaven's sake, why in heaven and for Jesus' sake, you were saved in the first place and baptized in the Holy Ghost in the first place. And you study it and you read it until it hits you with the fire of heaven, and you jump up from where you're at and you run, go tell somebody, and it works in their life. And the power of God goes from there to there. Listen, that's why the Lord starts off with Jerusalem first, because he says it's got to be a one-on-one basis first. It's got to be the person that's right beside of you, and then it's got to be the person that's next to them, then it's got to be the person that's across the street, then it's got to be the person in the community, then it's got to be the person in the region, then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Then it's the nations. Ask me for the nations. You ask God for the nations, and you're like, well, God, well, give me the nations. He's bringing people constantly to you, and you're just going, oh, give me the nations. People are constantly coming out on time for you. Give me the nations. Oh, God. No, give me the nations. And here, when you're asking him to give you the nations, he's bringing somebody to get you to the nations, to show you, to get you trained, to get you developed. Every person, you're gonna have to quit believing in the law of random events and coincidence, and start getting yourself over into a realm where God, the Holy Ghost himself, is in charge of your life. And everybody who comes in front of you, you are responsible. You are not responsible for the person in the Congo that you've never seen. But you are responsible for every face that your eyes make contact with. God brought them to you. God brought them to you. And the lack of compassion in your life, and the lack, is because of the lack of fire in your life. It's the lack of the reality of the Holy Ghost. Listen to me. Somebody said, are you screaming now? Oh, I'm passionate. Amen. I'm telling you right now. We can go down the list of the proofs of where the fire of God's not burning in people's lives, where people live out their own life for themselves and have all the right excuses and all the right answers. Oh, we can't tell people about Jesus here in the school system. Yeah, that's why the school system is in a state that it's in, because people like you listen to that demonic oppressive lie. And didn't stand up and do what's right. Huh? Daniel wouldn't have done it. Samuel wouldn't have done it. Moses wouldn't have done it. Jesus wouldn't have done it. Paul wouldn't have done it. Nobody else that's on God's side would have done it, that you have witnessed in the Bible. The only person that would do it that you can possibly think of is you. And now you're a unique character. You're the odd ball out. You're the odd ball out. When it stands to being compared to the company of God. Come on, people. That should cause a weeping. It should cause a bending of the knee. People get hungry for food, it drives them to the table. You get hungry from the things of the Spirit, it'll drive you to your knees. Jesus was moved with great compassion to bring you into the kingdom. Jesus was moved with such love that he did not value his own life, his own existence, that he may ransom you. Father wants that love to be formed in our lives. He wants that love to be formed in your life. And it's not going to happen just sitting here tonight. The beginning of it is here, as it's been almost every night, if not every night. The seed of it's here. The rain of it's here. The glory of it's here. The fire of it's here. But it's got to find some ground where which it can take root. It's got to find a life. People say, I'm saved by faith alone. No, you're not. No, you're not. Go back and read James' dialogue. I mean, of course, when I said you have not, because that's out of James chapter 4, I believe verse 7. But James chapter 2, he's giving a monologue there about how men are not saved by faith alone. Because the reality of God's faith is going to produce within your life God's deeds. God's deeds. Not out of a religious obligation. Not, I got to go get to work. Oh, I'm not saved, but I'll go get to work. That's legalism. That's obligation. No, I'm talking about you're going to have to come to a place where you sit down at the feet of Jesus, where you begin to interact with him, and a love relationship gets developed, where you have a connection with the Father and with the Son and with the Holy Ghost that gets mentored and developed in that same place, in a place isolated and separated and alone with him, where he talks to you and there's an interaction going on that has absolutely nothing to do with anything else in the world, anyone else at all. Any church service, any meeting, any prayer meeting, it's between you and him. But when you bring that person in relationship with the Lord to the prayer meeting, whoo! hallelujah. You're adding something. Hallelujah. When you bring that person in relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ that has been developed. Listen, every one of you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm talking to you about developing it. I'm talking to you about it coming to a maturity to where it looks something like somebody in the Bible. Hello. Yeah. Please show me yourself in the Word and what you're doing. Show me in the Word. Amen.
Amen.
I'm arming you with a whole bunch of things to pray about. To begin to talk with the Lord about. I say, Lord, I'm tired. I'm tired of being barren.
Yeah.
Hannah, look at Hannah's prayer. God! Huh? It made her, it got her so over, she was so overwhelmed. Eli thought she was drunk. I'm tired of being barren. I'm tired of being ashamed and a reproach. What God did through that prayer. I'll tell you what God will do through your prayer as he did. He'll do through your prayer exactly what he's done through everybody else's prayer that learned how to take hold of him. That's why God has elevated prayer to such a high level. Somebody can be nobody in the backwoods of nowhere, and they can change nation because if they will learn through relationship on how to take hold of God. People, when will you start? It's going to be painful for you, especially as you get older. And your life is about you, and especially in this age where it's about all the thrills and the entertainment and whatever it is that you get high on. Some people are high on sleep. Some people are high on staying up all night watching movies. Some people are high on shopping. Some people, what gets you excited? Can you get excited about going into a room, a closet, closed, shutting yourself in with God, getting down on your knees and beginning to cry out towards heaven and having all heaven begin to move in the place?
Yes.
Just start getting excited about it. Oh, no, I need some special little music. I would like to have, I'm thinking I'm hiring a choir, potentially. I've got to have my CD and my incense and specific lights, and the light bulbs burn out, and I haven't been able to find a place to replace those bulbs, so I'm on hold right now. See, not a lot of people are laughing because people are doing that in here. They got to have a certain kind of environment. Paul prayed. Paul prayed in the midnight hour, chained in the prison. Huh? And it was powerful. Hallelujah. Paul prayed in the midst of the congregation of Israel, all getting ready to take him, you know, kill him. And it was powerful. Paul prayed in the midst of the school at Tyrannus. And it was heard throughout all the region. They brought the sick and the diseased from everywhere. It didn't matter. Same way with Jesus. Why don't you go ahead and start being like them? Instead of like you. Or somebody else that needs whatever it is they need that's not in the Bible. All right. Huh. Why can't prayer become for you the offering of yourself like Abraham offered Isaac? Why can't prayer be the offering of the sacrifice, the evening and the morning sacrifice, like God so delighted in when people's hearts were in it and it was something that was pure and holy and worship towards Him? Amen. Why can't it be about Him and not you? Why can't it be about what He needs and what He desires and what He's requested rather than all the needs that you've accumulated concerning how it's got to be done on your behalf? Amen. Thank you, Catherine. I got one amen, several amens. Everybody else got this major, like, you know, look, the look that you have just before the hurricane's about to strike. Because you had to be from the South to understand that. But right after the first earthquake, tremors. I know exactly where you're at, so I got you cornered. Say, oh, no, you don't. Yeah, I do. I know exactly what's going on here tonight. Hallelujah. Today, you know, spent the day just doing what I normally do. Just see, the apostles had it right in Acts chapter 6, verse 4. They said, we give ourselves continually to prayer. We did the ministry of the word. And so, and the Lord just didn't give it. You know, I had impressions and things from heaven all day long. But I didn't know what I was going to minister on tonight. I was driving here, like, Lord, what are you going to minister on? And nothing from heaven. And then I got here, and the Lord just very, very, very clearly told me what He wanted me to minister. I got this just for you tonight, just before I started preaching. Right out of heaven. Baked up personally by Almighty God Himself. Beautiful bread. Some of you don't look like you're enjoying it at all. It's fresh bread. Recipe specifically designed for you, God giving you exactly what you need. And honestly, some of you look like you're eating the spinach, the sour greens, because, like, I wanted to be bragged on tonight. Listen. Let's just brag on Jesus. Let's brag on Jesus and let's run a race. Huh? You know, nobody gets bragged on until you get over the finish line. Hello. Wait. The Lord will brag on you in that day. You ain't home yet. Hallelujah. Praise God. Right now, it's time to begin to press in. I mean, there's people all over America talking about the move of God, but who's going to pay the price? Who's going to do what God says to do? Everybody wants to have it their own way. God says it's got to be my way. You can't diminish one word. Stand and declare to these people who come before me, who enter into my courts, all that I put in your mouth, and diminish not a word from it. God's doing us to preach the gospel, to declare His word. It will bring change to the lives of those who hear it, whether they lost or whether they in the church. The word of God will cause you to, it will cause you to grow and mature if you begin to drink it down and say, this is delicious. Begin to eat the meat of it. Huh? Delicious. Hallelujah. Come over here and let me bless you. Savory meat. This ain't even meat. This is just milk. This is the nourishment of the word. This is the nourishment of the word. Hallelujah. Come on, Papa wants to start showing us. He wants to show us. visibly, as it were, show us greater works. But first of all, he wants to show us how to come and have a conversation with him. He wants to show us how to come and delight in him, how to interact with him. He wants to show us about how more beautiful, how much more beautiful heaven is than earth is. He wants to show us how where to receive all the strength and all the divine ability that we need to do that which he's called us to do. He's calling us. You need to get yourself, I'm gonna see if how many more people I can make. It's real sad as I say this. You need an hour of prayer. I mean, I tell you right now, it's like things, like the life was sucked out of the room when I started talking about it. An hour? It's been difficult for me to find 5 minutes. I started praying. I looked at the clock, and it was 1 minute after eight. And I gave it all I had. I was out of strength. I looked at the clock. It was 3 minutes after eight. There was a day it was that way for me. I get up early in the morning to pray. I set the alarm clock so I wouldn't pray over an hour. I kid you not. I set the alarm clock so that I wouldn't go past an hour being so caught away. I had confidence. I gave it all I had, everything I had, with great intensity. And I looked at the clock, and only 5 minutes had gone by. But I didn't stop. Come on, people. Come on now. Come on now. I know what it's like. You're going to go run a marathon. You can't run a block. I know when you're sitting there thinking about it, I can do a marathon. Then you get the gear on and you're all warmed up. You get out there and in the first block, you're like, this hurts. Yes, it hurts. It hurts. Why? Because you're out of shape. You're not developed for it. What are you going to do? Go sit, go back to the living room and have a lemonade. And get a massage. Are you willing to come feel a little pain? Are you willing to come and enter into getting some development going on in your life? Recognizing how earthly you are is a terrible event. But it'll bring glory and honor and change. Huh? And it's measurable. It is measurable. It is measurable because as it begins to develop in your life, you become passionate about it, hungry. You can't even imagine having a day without it. All of a sudden, you begin to develop like Daniel. Can't even imagine not having 3 times a day without it. Oh, throw me to the lions instead. Men who know how to take hold of God. See, Daniel became a new kind of leader. He became a new kind of judge. He became a new kind of king. He became a new kind of prophet. He became the leader of Israel under the domination of another nation. Amazing, huh? Somebody, how? He knew how to pray. So it goes over and over and over again. As I ministered to you a week ago tonight on the prayers of the Lord Jesus, how he was constantly going to a solitary place to pray, to understand that there's a transfiguration there. There's a realm of touching glory that you'd be transfigured there. There's about a second. What is your favorite thing to do? I want you to just think about that. You don't answer. What's your favorite thing to do? What you enjoy doing the most? Your greatest thrill, your funnest time. One of my favorite things to do. The problem is one of your favorite things to do is a category that consumes all your time. And usually it's something like, huh? This earth, purely earthly. Father wants us to come and begin to interact with the spiritual and understand how glorious it is. We've understood how enjoyable it is to go surfing, play basketball, play tennis, whatever it is that you do for entertainment. Some people don't get quite that active. Video games. You got really strong thumbs. Hours. Satan's tricks. And I like playing tennis. I like playing basketball. I like going surfing. But I rarely find time for it. There's another realm. There's a much better place to find your life being occupied. We're calling you tonight. People, without you, we're not going to do it. Without your help, it's not going to get done. Without there being a people upon the earth lifting up their voice and crying out to heaven, nothing's going to happen. Does she have to go? Okay. I want people to stay in the meeting. I want you to stay in the meeting. We got to have you. We got to raise people up. We got to have your kids. If you don't, look, please give the kingdom your kids. Come on. Model these things for them, people. It's got to be a change. You're not going to have God's results, heaven's results, if we're not going to participate with Father's way. If we're not going to do it His way, we're not going to have His results, period. I'm telling you that you've got to be years at this. You might be. There have been many who were. Hudson Taylor gave himself to prayer and laid his life upon the mission field and had one soul saved. But there's 200 million standing in the place now. And they built a monument to him because they recognize he sowed the seeds of revival to his consecrated life as he laid his life down for China. Same with praying night. Listen, we want you to have a we want you to take your place at the table.
Yeah. Amen.
We want you to take your place in the presence of the Lord. Come learn how to stand before the Lord. In Luke chapter 6, I said 7, didn't I? I said Luke chapter 11. Yes, Luke chapter 11. Verse 5. And he said to them, which of you shall have a friend and should go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves? Most of you would say, don't you come over to my house at midnight. I got to get up for work in the morning. Hey? For a friend of mine is in his journey has come to me and I'm nothing to set before him. And from within, she'll answer and say, get out of here, or trouble me not. The door is now shut. My children are with me in bed, and I'm not getting up. I cannot rise and give thee. It's midnight. Hello. Why can't you come at a reasonable hour? I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he's a friend, yet because of his boldness, his shameless boldness, in other words, he's not going to stop banging on the door and banging on your window and continuing to harass you until you get up. And for that reason, you know this guy. You know, he's rude. He's not going to leave. And until I get up and get him something, we're going to hear this. So I might as well get up right now. And he will give him as much as he needs. I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given to you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened. People, the Lord is simply saying you have not because you ask not. And I want you to begin to move with me into a place of really positioning yourselves and ourselves to have these works and greater works. I want you to begin to position with me in this place where Father says, I want you to ask me so that I can answer you, so that my Son, Christ Jesus, will be glorified in you receiving what you ask. People, you're going to have to understand, we redefine prayer and asking to be something that it's not. It's rather a relationship interaction with the Lord that is developed in our life. With it comes an increase of faith. With it comes an increase in the power of God. Listen, I'm not talking to a bunch of ears tonight that are not going to have feet with them. I'm talking to ears that have feet. Amen. Are you listening? Ears that got feet, got hands, got mouth, got the rest of the body. So that something can be done with what's heard. Are you listening to me? I'm telling you, Father holds you and I accountable. It's going to demand change. It's going to demand crisis in your life. It's going to demand you having to confront you. And recognize how easily you burn out. And that's exactly what God wants to shut off in your life. Now you'll get firsthand knowledge of what needs to shut down. Hallelujah. So the Spirit of the Lord can begin to speak. And then in that crisis, in that place of just waiting before the Lord and crying out to Him. And it might just be a prayer for you. Some of you might just be a prayer. Change me, Lord. Change me. God, I want to know you. I know you're there. I know you're there. Oh, God, but I need you to show me. I need you to reveal yourself to me. You just begin, Katie, just begin to cry out to God like that. Don't play around. Don't play around. Get real with Him. And you'll discover how real He is. You cannot be lazy with God, nor deprioritize the means by which spiritual strength comes and expect that somehow you're going to live the life that God's called us to live. People are constantly overcome by sin and iniquity simply because they didn't have anything to eat. They didn't give any place to the Holy Ghost. They didn't give any place to the Word of God in their life. Somebody said, why am I so weak? I'll tell people over and again. If I read the Bible as little as you do, I'd be as weak as you are. If I prayed as little as you, if I interacted with God as little as you do, I would be all consumed with the things that you're consumed with. I, by my will, voluntarily place God first. I decide, I want Father, I want to interact with you. Father, the first thing I'm doing when I get up in the morning is I'm seeking you. I'm laying hold on you. I'm be filled with you. I'm be touched by you. That changes everything. Tonight, God's calling you. He wants you to come on in. He wants you to step out of the realms of which you've been living in and come on in and begin to put Him first in your life and let Him show you how to be continually filled. Let Him show you the meaning and the beauty and the splendor of walking out a relationship with Him. That I've watched a lot of people run around in circles, fire of God, they have revival week, they have revival month, they do fine for 2-3 months, and then boom, they plummet again. I watch this stuff go on over and over again. People have revival week and everybody gets all excited and everybody's repenting, but then what they don't understand is they don't know the power of deliverance. They go right back to the way that they were living and they go, wait a minute. They had a real encounter with God. Yeah, that was a real event. Yeah, that was a real move. But somebody didn't tell them, you've got to change. One of the great things that God did through Carlos Anacondia was to help people understand what they've got to do to change. He would bring people as they came and were delivered and set free, and he'd take them in to the deliverance tent. And really, it was all about to say, okay, it's time for you now to forgive those people that need to be forgiven. It's now time for you to deal with your hurts and your offenses. It's now time for you to renounce things that you've had going on in your life. It's time for you to recognize now That everything about your life is going to have to change. You're going to have to be willing to put God first. You're going to have to make church first. You're going to have to make the study of the Word first. You're going to have to understand how to get hooked up with people who can teach you and mentor you to interact with God and know how to move into things of the Spirit. You get up from this place tonight and you go back and you live your life just like you've lived it. You will have the same results until you die. They'll only get worse. Because God's not interested in good. God's not interested in men's performance. Father's interested only in our lives being consumed with the glory of His presence and our yieldedness to the realms of the Holy Ghost so that Christ Jesus may be seen, so that heaven can be revealed through our lives. God's not interested in all of our works and all of our deeds. He's not interested in circumcision, uncircumcision. All that matters to Him is a new creation and someone living like it. A new creation that can only be defined by the person and the life of Jesus Christ and not when He was 1 year old. Three people laugh, the rest are stunned. Somebody said, what'd he say? Rawr. What do you say? God's not going to legislate it. I wish He would. But the results that come, the great results that come from it, because people are willing to participate, voluntary offering. To go, you go home tonight and you lay down on your head upon your pillow and you say, okay, Lord, I'm ready to get in the program. I'm ready to understand what it means to come to dreams and visions in You. I'm ready to come to realize what it means to have a continual growth, not a drifting, not a stagnation. Look, listen to me. To come into a place where you can, there's tongues, interpretation of tongues, but that's all you have, that's stagnant. Come to a place where you can say hallelujah and a couple of shouts, but that's all you have, that's stagnant. There's supposed to be a continual increasing, moving forward. There's supposed to be a prayer that's going on in our life saying, Lord, use me. Father, use me, that ultimately brings more open doors, that brings more souls, that brings more people set free, more people established in the faith.
Yes.
Prayer. I mean, you listen to Paul as he cries out for the church to pray on his behalf, that he may open his mouth and make known the gospel as he ought, the power of praying saints. Not just a 5 minute, we'll give you a 2.5 minute quickie. Oh Lord, you see Paul over there needs some help and I don't really know what he's doing and I'm not really that much connected with him, but God, you know, we pray Your will be done over there. And you know, I told him I was going to pray for him, so I'm praying for him, and whatever You can do, please help him. Amen. And Lord, we're not really sure what pastor's talking about going to Kashmir. We're not really sure why he's going to go over there. Sometimes I think he's just Indiana Jones in the spirit. I don't really get it. I don't really feel it. I don't really know it. And that's probably because I'm so distant and adrift. Haven't really reached a lost soul in the past 5 years anyway, but let's forget about that. Show back on Pastor Mark. Anyways, he's going to go there. God help Ann, because he's leading her right in the big metal of it. And she's just going because she's sweet and obedient. So I was and the Lord, I don't know about the elections. I don't really care about them. Don't really care, concerned too much about the nation anyways. Because after all, I'm just hoping I'm going to get a promotion. Remember my promotion, Father. I'm just going to bring my promotion to You. I need that raise. You recognize, Father, that we just feel like that we need to get that other house. You know, we were believing for that other vacation. You know, that other boat. That's asking amiss to be consumed in your own lust. No, to get into the other stuff, you got to have spirit knowledge. You can't feel it because you don't have spirit knowledge. You just need to obey.
Yes.
Well, it's just not real to me. Yeah, I understand. You don't have spirit knowledge. That's why it's not real to you. I can tell you a lot of other things about God's not real to you either. I want to shake you. I want to shake you just a little bit. I want to ask you how you've let God form within you his heart, his passions, what he feels, what he's declaring to do. I praise God for all the people right now that are praying and believing God. Listen to me. You hear me very carefully. Those of you watching my web, let's listen to me. And this is really about you. I'm not talking about anybody else. I'm talking about you, and everybody else gets to listen in. I'm talking about us. You can sit there and look at me and you can think whatever you want, but I'm responsible for this church, and Father's given me a mandate, and he's put his word in my mouth for a result that he wants to produce. You can think it's about you and get upset and whatever. It isn't about you. You're getting an opportunity to participate. That's all it's about you in here. I'm not here to please you, make you happy, powder, puff your pew or whatever, you know. Whatever, you know what I'm saying. I'm here to make you comfortable. I'm here to get the result that God called me to get. Amen. Yeah, you are fortunate that you even have the opportunity to sit in here and listen to this. Amen. That's all there is to it. If you don't understand how fortunate you are, if you're so negative that you're constantly complaining about your situation and don't understand how to recognize those things that God has given you an opportunity to participate with, that's your lack of spiritual knowledge. What you can do is you can begin to get happy about everything and then just kind of go over all into all the other things as well. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. If you're in tribulation right now as you're listening to me minister, you can learn how to rejoice in your tribulation. Praise God. Hallelujah. There are many people right now, they're praying, they believe in God that there's going to be an outpouring of the Spirit of the Lord in Southern California in April as they do Azusa celebration. And I think that's great. I'm glad that they're praying. But you know what? No revival's ever come where people are having the latest and greatest in worship bands and music bands and speakers, and everybody's coming there for one big, huge entertainment celebration. Just has never happened that way. It's never happened that way. You know how it's happened? It's happened in hungry, desperate churches where people have nothing to live for or to look for but God. And they see that they're falling far short of that, and they become desperate. And that is the environment for heaven. You've got to hate your life in this world. You've got to be fed up and done with all your earthly interest. And that's painful. Because people have become so accustomed to all their interests and all their stuff that they're sporting and modeling out there as calling gang godliness. No, revival's not born that way. You don't find it in history anywhere. You find it in the same kind of things like you have where there's people whose lives are being threatened by the government and by their leadership. They're outcast from the church. 120 in an upper room, fearing for their life. All they want is heaven, and they're in expectation to be there. Rest for this, it's the environment. They have no other desire, no other meaning, no other value. Take a piece of paper and be very honest and write down your meaning and write down your value, write down your worth. Come on now. Be honest, though. Don't be all spiritual. Don't be writing down what it's supposed to be. Or you could write it down, just write it down what you're dreaming it to be, and then somebody ought to come and write down what are you actually doing. Because it takes that kind of confronting truth for us to bring to have change. Everybody just wants to feel good. Oh, is it making me feel good? I was hoping for a joy night. But this is a joy night. When are we going to have one of those like meetings you were talking about being like beside ourselves? People, I want to break the news to you. There's a whole lot more cross than what we're talking about here tonight. In reality, I'm not really even talking cross here. If I was exhorting you like some people that I know, exhorting the congregation, it's going to be fine when you're thrown in prison tomorrow. Don't worry about it. I've been there. I was there for 4 years. The Lord was with me through all of the torture. Listen, I'm telling you, these are sermons that are preached on the earth today. Right, okay? Some of you, actually tonight, you look like I'm giving you that message about you're going to be arrested tomorrow, you're going to be thrown in prison, but don't worry, I've been there. You won't probably be in for more than 4 to 6 years. God will give you the grace to deal with the torture. I'm just saying there's a whole lot more cross than I'm talking to you about tonight. Because the covenant is that we've lost our life. The covenant is that, Lord, I'm erasing the chalkboard of my life. I now live in you. You tell me what you want to do. I go to the Word. I read it. Okay, this is what you want me to do. I'm headed straight for it. Amen. Father, now I don't want to be distracted. Don't let anything distract me. Now, if you'll just begin to spend time with the Lord in prayer, like I'm telling you, just give the Lord an hour a day. The Moravians, God used the Moravians to impact the nations of the earth. They found a place of where they just began to have prayer meetings, all night prayer meetings. And then everybody took an hour of prayer and took rotations of an hour in prayer. And then there was sometimes 3, 4, 5 people praying each hour, 24 hours, around the clock, went on for 100 years. From the Moravians came Wesley. From the Moravians really came Whitfield and others. Anglican Church and its big organization with all of its money and all of its people looked at the little small Moravian church and said they sent more missionaries to the field than all of the churches of England combined. Why? They touched prayer. Men and women were raised up know how to move heaven through prayer. Come on, people. Talking with God is a whole lot better than talking on his behalf. It's time you and I learn how to talk with the Father. It's time when we just get to learn to get to know. We get excited about it as we get to talking to one another. Once again, the roar of conversation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. When we talk about these works and greater works, when we talk about receiving, having whatever we ask, these amazingly almost seeming out of reach declarations of the Word of God is always in the context of relationship. Faith, increased faith, it's relationship. All of that is always developed within the context, number one, of our place of interacting with Him. Just you and me, Father. You and me, Holy Spirit. He's not far away. Holy Spirit, I want to fill you right now. Let me fill you right now. And you step into a place where that actually, you ask and it happens. It wasn't that way at first, because you didn't know how to yield. It could have been that way at first. You say, Holy Spirit, let me feel you now. Lord, let me feel your joy, whatever. And I have to be very careful, because I'll go away and I won't be able to. I'll go away, and then won't be able to talk. Because it becomes very real. Interaction with Him becomes very real. It doesn't start with it that way because you don't know how to yield. You come to church, we pray for you. Some of you stand like I'm praying for that wall right there. I don't tell you, but it's like I might as well just go over and pray for the wall. If feels exactly the same. Receive. Receive. Go ahead, receive. Exactly the same. Feels exactly the same. The Lord wants to teach you how to have all that He's supplying. Because it's not a lie. It's not fictional. He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. It's not a lie. It's not fictional. We can be continually filled with the Spirit, speaking to ourselves in Psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. It's not a lie. It's not fictional. Take a little drink, and it'll be a gusher coming up out of you. Rivers of heaven flowing. I haven't. The way that I view it, and I believe I'm correct, I have not experienced the display, the full display of what it means to have rivers of the Holy Ghost issuing forth from my life. The full display of it. I have it, but not the full display of it. Somebody said, well, what's the difference? It's being willing to yield to Him and receive from Him. What impacts that? Your hunger. Father's produced hunger in your life tonight by the word going forth and ministry by the Spirit. Now you have to do something with that. Now you have to move out in that. You know, I don't really want a nursery. I don't know what's going on in there. I want people's souls preserved unto heaven. That's what I want. You know what? You're not going to get it unless you do it exactly God's way. You're going to get it. People say, why are you so passionate? Because I know if you alter a word from it, you're not going to get God's results. You're going to come, they're going to weep, and they're going to cry, and they're going to say, why did it turn out this way? It turned out this way because you didn't do it exactly God's way. Well, I did my best. Well, you know, whatever. You did your best. You didn't do it God's way. Well, the Lord understands. He doesn't understand nothing. Obedience is simple. It's a decision while you're doing your best. Obeying God. The Father didn't say you're going to have to grow wings and fly to the moon. And then you're going to get what I have for you. He made it real simple. Obey me. Just do exactly what I say. Don't alter it. Do it exactly like I told you to do it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to stand with me. Hallelujah. People, you got, listen, dear people, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm just not sure. I mean, I know my volume's up. You're going to have to contend for the faith. You're going to have to fight for your kids. Your children need to be in the Word, under the Word. You hear me?
Yes.
Even if they're sleeping on the floor, they need to be under the Word. They need to continually be under the Word.
Amen.
They need to be in the moving of the Spirit. And that's exactly why I said I'm not sure that I want a nursery. Okay, imagine that the Lord's looking at our life and He's aching. Imagine that He's aching. It's like, oh. Imagine it's kind of like you had a girlfriend or a boyfriend and you found out
that they were dating someone else. Or even worse, you had a husband or wife and you found out that they were seeing someone else. Oh, imagine that's Father. And it's really over us telling him how much we love him and how blessed we are by him. And then we go and we live our lives the way we believe it's supposed to be done. And we make our decisions based upon the counsel of the ungodly. He said, it ain't going to work for you. And we go stand in the way of sinners. Or we sit in the seat of the scornful. Going to work out. The Lord says, blessed is the man who doesn't do these things. I'm going to tell you right now, you will never understand how to live the life of the Holy Ghost, live the life of the Spirit, until you begin to find your life, studying the Word and conforming to it, saying, yes, Lord, okay, I'm going to do that. You're never going to understand the life of the Spirit until you're willing to begin to interact with Father and talk with him and say, Father, I just want the things in my life that you want in for my life. I want to know you. I want to feel you. I'm being overwhelmed by you. I want my attitudes to be changed as I'm standing here. If I'm unhappy, I want to become happy. If I'm sad, I want to begin to rejoice. If I'm in doubt or fearful, I want to become full of faith. If I'm in any way disobedient, I want to become obedient. If I've in any way been proud or arrogant and doing it my own way, I want to learn lowliness, meekness. I'm going to tell you right now, one of the things that I bang on heaven about continually is, Lord, I know that the way in is for me to come and be taught of you and to learn your lowliness and learn your meekness. And Lord, I want in every way learn this Holy Spirit. I can't do it on my own. Lord, let me understand what it means to wash the feet, oh Lord, of those who don't get it. And administer to those people who may end up betraying me, but for right now they're willing to listen. So far as I know, I'm not living my own life. Because I could write out my life. If I was going to live my own life, I could write it out, what it looks like. Because I can go make money just like everybody else can go make money. I can go do all these other things too. I'm a consecrate. Holy Ghost came upon me and consecrated me for heaven. And I'm so blessed. Christ Jesus bore my sins in his own body at the Calvary's cross. And should I do less in return? Tonight, Jesus is calling you. He's calling you. Dear people, he's not withheld any good thing from us. He's a good Father. It's a good pleasure to give us the Holy Ghost and give us the kingdom. But it's a responsiveness on our part to where we want it more than anything else. We want his life more than anything. And we're not going to rewrite it or redefine it or play make-believe. We're going to look at our life and say, okay, I'm not living for me. So, Lord, then lay some soul upon my heart. Father, help me to be very aware and mindful as I walk out the door and someone looks at me or I look at them and someone's in front of me. Now, how I can begin to interact with them based upon their soul and their state. Not so that, because I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not careful, you'll be so consumed with yourself, you're going to interact with them because you want them to like you. It's all going to be about this interaction of them liking you. And we remain lifeless, powerless to change anything. It's got to be rather that you're so moved by the compassion of the Holy Ghost that you love them. You love them so much you're not willing to see them leave you until their life has changed. And you begin to sow the word in their life and it's so impacted to you that you immediately, as soon as you leave them, you go find a place to get down on your knees because you recognize the power of prayer because you are a person
who's come into a place that you recognize that prayer is a power and authority with God. And that as you begin to pray for them. Carlos Anacondia told me about how God began to do what he did in the great revival begin in 1987 in South America. He'd go talk to people and he would come under such a great burden for them. He would go find this, wherever he could, even if he was someplace where he couldn't get away, he'd go find some place that, like needing to go to the bathroom, he really didn't need to go. He just went in there and began to pray, cry out to God. He was overwhelmed by the compassion of the Holy Ghost for people. And he would talk with them and it just seemed like it was very responsive, and then go and he'd find a place and he'd get down on his knees and he'd begin to bring them before the throne of heaven and he'd begin to name them. He'd begin to ask God, Father, take their heart and melt it. Oh God, cause their eyes to be open that they no longer resist you. Begin to cry out for their eternal soul. And then you know what happened? One day it exploded into a place where there were hundreds of thousands of people there. It wasn't just one, it wasn't just two, it wasn't just ten. It was hundreds of thousands of people. And then the rest is history. Of South America was shaken by the power of God. Nations were shaken by one man. We love him so much. We honor him so much. Elias got a hold of me today. Told me his dad's going to get in touch with me. I'm going to come to San Diego. We love him so much. I look at Carlos Anacondia and I see millions of souls that have come into the kingdom. Millions and millions and millions of people that have been established in the faith. Pastors that have been raised up. Tens of millions of churches changed. Father, how's that for you? But you've got at some place, you've got to have a crisis moment. He had his crisis moment. You know what his crisis was? Salvation. He was busy making all kinds of money, trying to keep it. One day he had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. He gave himself to Jesus. And he didn't stop. He never looked back. He never conformed. He never found a cush chair. He never found a mediocre lifestyle. He never found a moderate way to have God in his life and continue on with his own life. He went all out. Such is the story of every man and every woman who God has been able to use. And people, if there's ever a time that we've got to have folks that are going to rise up and that are going to take a hold of what God has given, it's now. It's now. You don't understand. The time is urgent. If you're listening to the voices of the world around there, them around you, it is going to silence the Spirit of God. The voice of the world becomes so loud you can't hear him speak anymore. You know you're right with God when you go into the fire and you come out and there's no smell of smoke on you. But when you go into it and you come out and there's a smell of world on you, God never sent you there. That's a compromise. If God gives you an assignment, you listen to me tonight. If God gives you an assignment, it's going to cause you to grow and mature in the things of the Spirit, to make you more hungry, to advance the giftings of the Spirit in your life. If it's not, you stop it now, because it's a lie. It's a deception. It might have started right, but it's gone wrong. It's gone wrong, and you're drifting. You're drifting. Listen to me. I know drift. I've watched it. I've watched a lot of people come and go. I've watched a lot of people get red hot, get started, and get cold, drift away. I've watched the multitudes come and the few that stayed. After a while, you get a feel for it. You can feel it. You can see it. And then as you grow in the Spirit, you don't even have to see it. You don't even have to feel it. The Lord grips your heart in the middle of the night, and you go, and he says, and he calls a name. You go, oh God. Oh God. Because he puts within us his own compassions, his own heart, his own awareness, his own concerns. You know why? God loves And he loves his people. And it's his model of love that we are to be conformed to, not the model of love of the world. It's his love that has a severity, a strictness, an absoluteness, an urgency, a demarcation, a very fine line. Narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there be that find it. Broad is the way that leads to destruction, and that's a traffic jam. And he was talking to his people. He wasn't talking to the world. He's talking because he was sent to the lost sheep of Israel. He was sent to the house of Israel. His talking was addressing Israel, which you and I are another dimension of, if you would. And they could be a type of the church. What will you do tonight? We walk out of here justified, unchanged. We walk out of here just saying, okay, well, you know, pastor says we got to pray for an hour. I'm going to work it in somehow. 15 minutes in the morning, 15 minutes at noon. And I want you to, you know, I'm just telling you, you need to pray till heaven, you touch heaven, heaven touches you. Till you feel the darabos tekerinaya. Till things change in your spirit. You need to read the Word of God till you're hungry for the Word of God and you can't put it down. I'm going to tell you right now, if you can put it down and you can go whole days, you there's problems in your spirit. And for me, that's backslidden. I'm not going to say it's backslidden for everybody because there's a lot of people never even developed it. It's moving forward to have it. It is, and it's a crisis. It's a terrible situation in the circumstance of the church. I'm always amazed when I find some young person who knows the Word of God, and I'm finding more millennials that are getting grabbing a hold of the Word of God. They're just being taught of God. You know what? And it's beautiful because they're being taught radical stuff. Consecration sold out to God. Hallelujah. I'm not interested in the American dream. I got a heavenly one. Uh-oh. I'm interested in living big for God, not living big for me. You may stand here tonight and think, as you analyze things, how can I quit my job? How can I change the way that I do my daily life? Once again, you're processing with the wrong things first. You have to say, Lord, I'm going to come to you. I'm going to come to seek your face. Because as you do, he changes everything. And then your job really does become a mission field. And it really does become about reaching the lost. And it does really be, and it causes you to go deeper in the things of the Spirit. And it causes the increase of the gifts of the Spirit to become more apparent. And hunger grows. And it's not working counter to the things of the kingdom. Because bottom line of it is, until you get the first things first, all you'd be is the same person without a job. Spiritually, because, huh, you know what I'm saying? Before you weren't seeking God with a job, now you're not seeking God without a job. Before you were worried and all bummed out and concerned when you had a job, now you're all worried, even more worried and bummed out, now you don't have one. It's like a leper trying to change his spot, an Ethiopian trying to change the color of the skin. Father changed our heart, he changed our spirit, and he put his Holy Spirit in us so that we have an open line of communication, an access, an entrance, an uninterrupted relationship with heaven. How can we take that for granted? We just can't do that no more. Just can't do it. Vastakina masateya. The Lord is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. He's crying out to us to seek His face, to seek His presence continually. He wants to fill us with every good thing. So just let Him, just let your hands towards heaven, just let Him touch you. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God. Thank you. Just turn your whole life over to Him. It's a very happy moment. Just turn your whole life over to Him. Turn your life over to Him. Just let Him take every part. Let Him have everything. Tonight, give God everything. Just give Him everything. He'll come overwhelm you with His good things. Just give Him everything tonight. Don't run the risk of living your life for you. Don't run the risk of living your life for you. Don't run the risk of living your life for you. Jesus. Jesus. Don't run the risk of living your life for you. Jesus. Father has a great anointing for every person in this place. But it's going to cost you. It's going to cost you your convenience. It's going to cost you your time. It's going to be at the expense of you doing your own will and living out your own life and doing the things that you've gotten comfortable with and that you've grown to really like and enjoy. But if you come step over here into this other place, you'll find a whole bunch of different things to like and to enjoy and to do that goes far beyond all those other things that you've come to like and enjoy and do. It's a crossing over. And I pray tonight in Jesus' name that there will not be one single person left in this place that is unwilling to go all the way with God and begin to make Him in every way first. And beginning that first beginning is about being filled up with Him at the start of every day, where His passions, where His thoughts and His life has a chance of being expressed through you. Only because you know how to be filled with Him. And it gets you past your concerns and your self-consciousness and your fears and your worries, your inabilities. You're trying to figure it out and think it through. He'll lead you now, one step at a time. God's calling you. God's calling you. He's calling you. Jesus is calling you. He's calling you and He's saying, come, take up your cross and follow Me. Come, take up your cross, deny yourself and follow Me. Come, let Me fill you with heaven. Let Me give you a heavenly vision. Let Me fill you with heaven. Come, I'll live in you. I'll live through you. You'll live in Me. You'll live by Me. You'll let My word abide in you, govern you, rule you. You'll ask whatever you will and I'll do it. You'll just abide in Me and let My word abide in you. Come over into this relationship. Come on over. Come on over. Come on over. Where the souls around you become more valuable to you than anything else. Where the praises of God are greater than the praises of men. Where His life more important than your life. Oh, because His life is glorious. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. There is the Buddha Nakadeya, is the Buddha Naya, Papa. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Lord, we give ourselves to You. Reveal Yourself fully through us, O God. Jesus' name. Jesus. Mamonta kina la masependi lipitando la papara. Tonight, the Holy Spirit would like to teach some of you how to pray. There's no inspirations like the inspirations of the Holy Ghost. Just let Him right where you're standing. Let Him touch you. He'll fill you with the passions of Father's heart. The one who's making intercession were the saints. That's what is the mind of the Father. He's making intercessions on the inside of you. Let him fill you now. Let Him fill you now. Let Him fill you right now with confidence. Let Him fill you right now with His love. Let Him fill you right now with faith. Let Him fill you right now with all these wonderful things that come out of that. Boldness and certainty. Let Him fill you right now. Let Him overwhelm you right now with His life. Jesus. Determine right now that you're going to be a bright, shining light of His presence everywhere you go. And recognize that unless you're full of the Holy Ghost, it's not even possible. Unless you're full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Ghost in such a way that it changes your attitude. It changes the way that you feel. It changes the way that you act. It changes the way that you look around and see life and people around you. It moves you with His love. It moves you with His compassion. It moves you with every dimension of His wonderful working power through the Holy Ghost. Understand, you cannot be no light. There's no way you can be a light. But decide tonight that you're going to be a bright, shining light. And recognize that in so doing, you're signing up to give yourself over to the Holy Ghost so He can teach you how to receive and how to be filled up with Him. And there, and then you begin to have the Holy Ghost evaluating things for you and comparing spiritual things to spiritual things. Then and there in that place, all of a sudden, you find the inspiration and the motivation and the power and the will and the insight to do it. Then, there you become able ministers of the Holy Spirit and not of the letter that kills. That's what the Lord says. Because He sees the heart of the people in this place tonight. Lay everything upon the altar of God. Lay everything upon the altar of God. And let the fire of God come and consume it. Lay everything upon the fire altar of God. Let Father's fire come and consume it. And then everything that you will be doing will be filled with His presence. Everything that then you rise up to do will result in His word going forth, His witness being made known, His life being seen. And no, it won't be a sorrow to you anymore. It won't be something that is out of order anymore. But your steps will rather be ordered of the Lord, and it will be a joy, and it will be a celebration. And it will bear fruit. And it will bear fruit. There will be salvations that will come of it. You get filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm going to tell you right now, you'll have people touched by the power of God everywhere you go. Everywhere you go. Mandaraste kiti bara nastoto. And that's the value of carrying cards with you. With church addresses. I remember one, I've been in many, many times, different situations where people were ministered to. One woman, she was at a time where we were giving out magnetic cards. And she put it on her refrigerator. A year later, she gave her life to the Lord and had church come to because she had a magnetic card on her refrigerator. She said she didn't know why she put it on there, she just did. Well, then she learned why she did. There's all kinds of testimonies like that. We go bearing precious seed with a compassion, weeping, a compassion. I was watching the other night as A. Allen was praying for that boy who had no bones in his legs, that little baby. And then bones immediately came, stood that baby up. I was watching all the compassion that was coming out. I was watching Oral Roberts the other night as he was praying for a person, a young boy who had a terrible disease, and you could see he was overwhelmed with compassion. The compassion of Jesus was coming forth. It's a benchmark of how much you flow in the Holy Ghost. It really is. It's a benchmark. Let that compassion, Jesus, take over your life. Whew. Believe God for souls. If you don't begin to let faith become developed in prayer and crying out to God for the lost, crying out to God to use you to reach the lost. If you don't begin to understand the passion that caused many men to pray, Lord, give me souls that I die. Give me these souls that I die. To where it's just that real. It's not just a phrase. It's just that real. It's just that real. It's that real. Where it becomes more than one of your loved ones having fallen into the flames of hell and died there. Begin to carry the burden of the Lord Jesus Christ for a lost and dying world. It's never going to be formed in you not. It's never going to be formed in you just doing your own thing. It won't happen. It won't happen. But if you come over here, you begin to walk this out with the Lord. You begin to get into a relationship where you just, you can't make yourself burden for the lost. You can't give yourself compassion. You can't provide for yourself the love of God. You can't provide for yourself the life of God. It comes by way of the Holy Ghost. There's no place like giving yourself to the study of the Word and to this place of prayer, relationship prayer, where you're interacting with Him, not just religious prayer, not your little prayer list, not the things that religion has defined prayer. I'm talking about you enjoying His presence, interacting with Him, making your request known, asking, seeking, knocking, being right there in that place where the Holy Spirit can now begin to enlarge your ability to speak on, as it were, His behalf to heaven. These things are formed in you. You can become very sensitive to the Holy Ghost. If I could just convince you tonight that the more you give yourself to the manifest presence of God, the stronger that it gets. The more you give yourself to this relationship interaction, the deeper it gets. The more you give yourself to prayer, the more powerful the results. You just determine tonight. Determine tonight. I don't have to ask anybody to determine tonight that you're going to have breakfast and supper tomorrow. Or to chisel out some time to have breakfast and lunch and supper. There's a need in the natural. But God will make that spiritual need just as real, if you'll let Him. But it isn't just going to be a touch. It isn't just going to be something that you're going to come and get in a prayer line. It's going to be a consecration. It's going to be a commitment. Where you begin to sow to the Spirit, and out of the Spirit, out of sowing the Spirit, you begin to reap these things like a harvest in your life. Sometimes sowing has a bit of labor to it. It's a tilling up, and especially when it's fallow ground. It's a place that's never been a reality in your life. It's fallow ground. It's hard ground. It's never really been done. Boy, you really got to work that ground before it's ready for seed. But if you lay your hand to it, God, the Holy Ghost, works a miracle through it all. And gives you the grace and the ability to get it accomplished. And it doesn't take long, and fruit's going to begin to, the fruit of the life of God is going to begin to spring up. Amen. If you'll do this with me, if you'll do this thing, you listen to me. If you'll do this, less than a year would go by. Less than a year. And there would be great spiritual results in your life. You'd become so sensitive to the presence of the Lord as it is in right now, here right now, you'd be on your face before the Lord. You would be. I promise you. Give yourself to these things. You become very sensitive to what the Holy Ghost is saying, what the Holy Ghost is doing, what He's feeling, what He's thinking, and oh, what a wonderful life it is. Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. Jesus. Go find a place of prayer. Go find a place to shut in with Him. Go find a place to enjoy Him. Manas, I tell you. She learned to hear His voice. She learned to do His will. She learned to live His life. Jesus. Jesus. If there is anyone sick in your body, if you have any need whatsoever, we're here to pray for you. If you're watching by web right now, if you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, if you've never been born of the Spirit, if you've never stepped into this life that is in God, I want you to know that Father's vested all authority and power in the name of Jesus, that if you begin to speak that name of Jesus and begin to call upon the name of Jesus, I'm telling you, everything about your life will begin to change. The very atmosphere of the room that you're sitting in or standing in right now or the place that you're at will take on the glory of heaven as you begin to cry out in a true and sincere heart to God with that name, saying, Jesus, come, save me, change me. Lord Jesus, I want to know who you are. I want to live for you. I want that miracle of salvation. Work in my life right now. I surrender myself to you. Whatever it is that neediness would say, to say it in the name of Jesus when you cry out to God and ask Him to come rescue you, save you, change you. And He will. He's promised to do so. He'll give you a new heart. He'll give you a new spirit. And then just ask the Holy Ghost to come and fill you. Just begin to yield yourself to Him right now. And you can, at this very moment, not only be made a new creation, be born of the Spirit, but also baptized in the Holy Ghost all the same time. And you'll never look back, I guarantee you. I can feel the presence and the power of God coming to you right now as you're sitting there watching this. I feel it happening right now. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. The life's being changed right now. Your life's being changed right now. Maybe you backslid, maybe you turned away from God, but I'm telling you right now, He stands at the door of your heart knocking. He's saying, just open up a little bit. I'll come rushing in with all my power and all my glory. I'm telling you, God loves you so much, there's no way for you to get rid of that love that He has. It's a passionate love, and there's nothing like coming to knowing it. And don't stop short of knowing all the love of God. Don't just experience the wonderful joy of salvation. Now I'm telling you right now, there's a whole lot more. There's a lot of people that come to Jesus and all they've ever done is just known that initial bit of love. They've never been willing to go all the way with God. They were changed by the power of God, then they went on and lived their own life. Still went to church every day or on Sundays. Never come to know what it meant to really grow in the wonderful thing that they experienced at the first moment of salvation. It only gets bigger and better, and I pray in Jesus' name you will. You'll respond and go all the way with God. Well, just go part way with God. Pray that for you in Jesus' name. Once again, if there's anybody in this place here tonight, you want prayer for anything, I pray in Jesus' name, every one of you from this day forward, you'll make your life about what God made your life about. You'll make your life about souls and reaching the lost. You'll make your life about what Christ Jesus died at Calvary's cross for you to live for, so that you could be a living testimony of His Word. That you would speak only His Word, that you would live out His life, that you would flow in the realms of the Holy Ghost and be a bright shining light for a world around you that sits in darkness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Grace, what do you need, dear? You feel your what was wrong? Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, and it can't come back on you. Understand, listen to me. You understand this. Listen to this. Listen to this, because I can feel it. I have no problems with it. I can just feel it. The nauseousness, all that, it's just a spirit of sickness that can be resisted. You can give to it, you yield to it, because the more you yield to natural things, the more you're just automatically taken in it, just like a current in a stream. But when you learn to walk in the things of the Spirit, you can resist that, and it can't take you. And people want to make it viruses, and they want to, you know, just ask a virologist what a virus is. Come on. It's a bunch of head knowledge that means nothing. It's a fraction of the information on the true story. And so, forget about all that. Understand me, I'm telling you the truth. You can resist it. You can learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost where the current of the Holy Ghost takes you instead. Same way with hormones of every sort and type. Young hormones have problems, and old hormones have problems. And you want the results of neither. Amen. And especially older hormones. Everybody don't want the older hormones. Some people think they want the younger ones, but they had just devastating results. Hallelujah. Huh, babe?
Yes, sir.
We know how to deal with them. We just run them things off. And run them things off. But I'm telling you right now, it's a seeking, asking, knocking. There are many things that we have to get a breakthrough from. Some things flow easy. You know what the things that flow easy in your life? The things that you've got a breakthrough in. The things that you've laid hold of and received. And God has a right to develop us the way He's purposed to develop us. He gives us salvation by the asking, and He allows us to mature and grow and develop by the participation of it. And we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. But now, if need be, we're in heaviness through many different kinds of tribulation, that the trying of our faith, which is much more precious than gold, though it be tried by fire, can result in something. Praise and honor, glory that is coming. Father matures us and develops us. We learn how to endure hardness. We learn how to stand in faith. We learn how to not weary in well-doing. You know, if everything came instantly, you would never have a chance to weary. We don't weary in well-doing because we should reap if we don't faint. If everything came instantly, we wouldn't have an opportunity to faint. Everything does have a season on it. Many people faint and weary in the season because it's a trying of our faith. Because we're standing in a process or a place where we're asking, seeking, knocking. You know what I'm going to get? You know what I'm going to have? I'm going to have the great move of God, the Holy Ghost, in this region that I was promised 34 years ago. I'm going to have the impact in the nation. And I'm going to tell you right now, you know, to go through this, you're going to go through all kinds of persecution. Everybody's going to hate you. And you're going to have to learn how to love everybody through the process. Father has His way of preparing us for every good work. And when you know, when through relationship with Him, allowing the relationship to be developed, you listen to me, you know who He is. And He says, go sacrifice Isaac. You just go right on. You just go head right out. It's a done deal. Why? Because you know who He is. It's going to be good. Because He loves us so much, He's going to take good care of us. Whatever He asks, give it to Him. Whatever He asks. Because he's all He's wanting to do is to bless us with something greater. That's it. You're never going to know that until you develop a deeper relationship. You're never going to do that until you find a place where you're interacting with Him in a realm called prayer. Where the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, is able to overwhelm you, flood through you. And you come to a place of praying with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost, watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Building up yourself in your most holy faith. Whew. Praying in the apostasia. Praying in the masteterinia. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Jesus. Father, we thank you that the thyroid is healed.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And what is it that you need? Yes. Yes. Yes, Father, we thank you for Josh's willingness to begin to sow to the Spirit.
Yes.
Begin to labor. Begin to labor, God. Begin to labor in the ground of God of your choosing in his life. Now in the name of Jesus. Now in the name of Jesus. Now in the name of Jesus. Now in the name of Jesus, when you begin to talk to the Holy Ghost, when you begin to talk to the Lord Jesus, when you begin to address the Father, you begin to experience the overwhelming goodness of his presence.
Yes.
You begin to take up his cause. You begin to pray out his word. You begin to pray by his Spirit, by his knowledge. What do you need? What's up? Fully surrendered, a consecrate, separated, baptized, sanctified, bone to pastaterede, mandan brise, mong leng jesu daya. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Ribasa duriste kasht. What you need?
I want a life-changing increase in intimacy with Jesus.
Okay, Jesus, that's exactly what he wants. So you guys agree, so you got... See, think about it is, dear people, when you begin to start telling Father the things that he wants, you just stepped into agreement. And then that just... Yes. Yeah. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing amazing.
Well, that's good. That's good. That's good. Jesus. In the name of Jesus, you and no one else in this place allows excuses. No more. That's because reality of it is, that's deprioritizing heaven. That's making heaven at best second. And so in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, by the power of the Holy Ghost, you begin to walk in wisdom. You begin to walk in dedication to him. It's really easy, you know, when you begin to say, my life is not my own. Huh? Huh? When you understand your life's not your own, you know what I'm saying? You know what? This really actually begins to bring you to a place of having to deal with that. You say, well, my life is not my own. Why is it I'm having such a hard time finding an opportunity to pray and read the Bible if my life is not my own? Hey, see, it just brings you to the moment of having to deal with these things. Huh? And then you got an excuse, well, I had to do this, no, you didn't. Because the Lord said, forget about all that. He said, don't concern yourself with what you should wear or what you should eat. So he already eliminated that as an excuse or as a reason. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha dambaste ritana. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Great things. Great things. Great things. Hallelujah. Great things. Batalomosaya. Batalona Masaya Potanishi. Potalamangatia. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Zeto Ramonziste. Ambrostai. Ambrostai. Just lay hold on these things, Rob. Lay hold on these things, men. Lay hold on these things, men. Lay hold on them now. Lay hold on them. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Masaturis. Lay hold. Meshtirisaya. Lay hendamaya. Ukaristibia. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Manjesito. Manalai. You don't want to say. You know, sometimes people struggle. They think, what is it I'm going to say? How am I going to do it? How am I going to, how's this all going to work out in within the framework of my life? Don't even do that. Don't even think that way. Get yourself an hour of time set aside. The Lord said, can you watch with me but 1 hour? Can't you watch me with me 1 hour? He's saying it right now. Can't you watch with me 1 hour? People look and then read that and they go, and they read that and they go, poor Peter, those guys, man, they all messed up. Without even thinking that he's still saying that. And then they're the ones not responding. Because eventually, Peter responded. Can't you watch with me 1 hour? Because it's there that then the Lord forms within your mouth the ability to speak and makes a way and creates the opportunity and gives you the power and the ability to, where you don't have to look to your own understanding or look to the things of yourself or figure out how it's going to work out or how it's going to be done. Got to begin to work a miracle of revealing His Son. Suta aratepa to kina sipam. Pokini sitaya. Beresanto. You learn how to leave everything at the altar. You learn how to leave everything at the altar. Reach beyond God's purpose and will. No, you seek it. You seek it. You seek it. You seek it. Huh? Until you know exactly what His purpose for you to do. Huh? Because He's got a way of making it known and leading and guiding. I guarantee you, He won't hide nothing. He won't hide anything from His servants. Hallelujah. Harabotasta. He'll make it known. And He'll arrange it. Hallelujah. And He'll cause the fruit to shine forth of that which is right and that which is wrong. Sustest. 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 Find the place. Find the solitary place. Find the place. Some of you gonna find this place and you're gonna go, my goodness, I cannot believe why did I wait so long? Unbelievable. Is it? Hallelujah. And if there's any sickness over in this area, it got to go too. Amen. Oh, spirit of sickness. That's the perinished. Jesus. Jesus. Botakina masapata. Mon bratiste te de metipala. Jesus. 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 You never drift when you're pressing in. Believe me. You never drift when you're pressing in. You just don't drift when you're pressing in. Huh. You don't drift when your sail is full of wind. Huh. Oh, when your anchor is set within the rock. Never drift. You just didn't drift. There's no drift in there. Ha. Just begin to let the life of the Holy Ghost take over you. Now in the name of Jesus, Just begin to let the life of the Holy Ghost take over you. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, just begin to let the life of Jesus take over you. Begin to let the life of the Spirit and the countenance of the Holy Ghost take over you. Yeah. That's what He wants to do. And when it's what He wants and we don't have it, it's because we're not agreeing with Him. And somehow, as a result, resisting Him. So don't do that now. Don't do that anymore. Don't do that anymore. Let the life and countenance of Jesus take over you. Hallelujah. We can see Native Americans get full of the Holy Ghost and stay joyful all the time. Yeah. I'm telling you right now. Somebody said melancholy was in their genes. No. That may be true. They got new genes now. Actually, it wasn't really even in the genes in the first place. It kind of was. Spiritually. Yes. Toshe duri da bota. Jesu tu robotara. Jesu tu robotara. Jesu tu robotara. Jesu tu robotara. Manda de te. Manda de ste kalina. Mambre dan. Membre desht. Mevretis. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Abba mande bremando se tu la mamana se. Just go. Just go to heaven. Seeing is that you died with the Lord Jesus Christ and been buried with Him by baptism His death, just go ahead and go to heaven. In Jesus' name.
Basta rebekiste pif. Basto prefetiste kiste veratust. Mandembre deve.
Every dimension of your spirit. Every dimension of your life. Mambasta de. Mangeya sita, conformed. Mandanda de sheke ritaya. To that which God the Holy Ghost is doing. By His command. By His command and by your agreement. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, mandala daya. Day unto day utter speech, and night unto knowledge. Night shows knowledge. Hallelujah. And as the heavens declare His handiwork, so the Spirit of the Lord makes known all of His works right here in the midst of you. So just receive. Just receive. Bose da de ram ja ja just kambo de asate he. Mandai just aya hara ha te ha. Man just. Mandreya. Ibrata. Mimbrata. Mimbrati nanamen. That's it. Sista. Mendefist. Gee. Mandam bradastus. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Mondaya. Mondaya. Mandebrus. Jesus. 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 Monzans on the deste. Mon giangio esiste. Mon brando le befe. Mon brava babatissima. Mon brava rabbiest. Mon brava facusiste. Let me say this. If everybody in this room tonight bought a one-way ticket in the morning to some remote part of the world where the gospel had never been heard. You got there, you'd begin to learn how to really live for Jesus. Because you're not going with a bank account, you're not going with support, you're not going with anybody who knows you. You got to go just completely to trust, completely with total abandonment. To fulfill and carry out those things as God described that we're supposed to go and do. With that total surrender, and as much as you already know about the Word and about the Spirit, you'd grow quickly. As long as you didn't tuck tail and call for somebody to call 911, get a rescue team to come get you because you lost your mind temporarily. No, you'd grow quickly, and it would not take long, and there'd begin to be many people starting to come into the kingdom. Your faith would become so strong. Your prayer life would go through this roof. The anointing in your life, and we wouldn't even be able to recognize you inside of a year. It's like, whoa. So why don't you begin to let the Spirit of the Lord show you how to buy a one-way ticket into heaven right now. To where that starting tomorrow morning, your life is about touching heaven, living for Him. Say, Lord, I don't know how to do this. I'm on a mission field. I'm on a foreign field now. Everything around me is foreign. I don't know how to do this. Without you, I can do nothing. And I want you to show me how. I want you to show me how to talk to you. You might walk up to the cash register lady and all you can just say in your spirit is, Lord, show me how to talk because I don't even know how to begin. But all of a sudden, you just now made huge advancement for the last time of walking by just snarling and hurrying out. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
And it won't be long. You begin to ask God like that, and you begin to talk to Him about those things. And suddenly your mouth will be filled. Yes. Suddenly compassion begin to grow. It won't be long. You'll find yourself going back to your car and just sobbing. Holy Ghost breakdown. Just sobbing for the lost. Everything will change. It ain't going to happen until you engage in a relationship with the Lord that goes beyond the place that you are in right now. Which is, in all honesty, when we look at it and we reckon it, it's not as much about the kingdom of God as it needs to be. It's not as much about the lost as it needs to be. And that's what I want the Lord to change. And then I'm going to tell you something too. You just listen to me. And I know a number of you are involved in sales in this place. You got to be careful with sales. Because I can feel it. When something is becoming, you really believe in the things that you're selling and whatnot, and I guess you're supposed to be able to be good at it. But then it becomes a deification of it. You're just glorifying it. It's just getting praised. Becoming the solution and the answer or whatever, you know. It's something you got to have. You can't live without it. You guys got to watch this stuff. Because there's people in here with Plexus and Rodan and Fields. Hey, watch that stuff. You better make sure you got a right balance. You better make sure it gets baptized in the Holy Ghost. And you know what you're saying. And it doesn't become inordinate. You could ask me about it because I can tell you. Okay? Because you say, well, I need to do this. Oh, yeah, well, you need to do that? Then you need to get rid of the job. You hear me? You listen to me. Because if something God's given you, then you need the Holy Ghost to do it. Huh? You need His direction to do it. You need to do it His way. So I want you to be very, very careful. Listen, there's some of you, I hear the Spirit of the Lord talking to you. Don't you drift. Look at yourself. Make sure that you're as on fire and as passionate for the things of the Spirit as you were last year. And you shouldn't have to go back a couple years. My goodness, if you have, you've been really drifting. Right? Just get right on track with the Lord. It's so easy to stay on track with the Lord. All you do is just say, Father, forgive me. Huh? Is it? It was simple. What was John? What was George Mueller? George Mueller, in his day, raised more money for orphans than any single person up until he had lived. He said, "I don't need to tell anybody. I don't need to market. I don't need to advertise. I go to my knees and I pray and I let God do the work." See. You can come to a place, there's so many people that have gone before us in this, that you can take a hold of heaven. You can come to a place in God where that when you begin to speak, heaven mobilized and earth produces. Now you listen to me. You're either going to give yourself today and for the rest of your life to sowing to the flesh, and had the flesh reaping corruption. And remember, when Paul said that in Galatians chapter 6, he was talking about where your money is and where your heart is, just how you give into the ministry. This is really what he was talking about. Whether you're going to spend it on yourself or spend it on the kingdom. This is really what he was talking about. Come on, give me a break. This is what he was saying. Go read it again. Now it has application. It's more broad than that. True. But I want you to grab hold of this people with me tonight. I want you to grab hold of this stuff with me tonight. Don't let go. I want you to hear me now. Hear me very carefully. Maybe it's people on the web. God didn't call you to make money. He called you to demonstrate heaven and reach the lost. What's the value of a soul? What's the value of a soul? Huh? What is the value of a soul? God valued his own life with it. So important to him. There is only one means, listen to me, there's only one means by which the power of hell can be broken off of someone, or that people can even ever have a hope of being saved. It is by the preaching of the word. If you cannot declare Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the cross of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, the fact that all men are lost until they receive this goodness and grace of God, then you're not preaching a gospel that will result in any souls being saved, and you're preaching another gospel. Hear me. And God will give you the ability to speak it. And the Lord just said it this way. He said, those who believe, go preach. Those that believe will be saved. Those that do not believe will be damned. And it's part of the gospel. We let people know. You have the right to receive, but I'm going to tell you what God said about it. If you believe, you'll be saved. But if you do not believe, you'll be damned. Do you think that that is going to confront powers of darkness? It absolutely is. But it can't be anything less. Huh? You can't tell people about your new hairstyle and that the Lord blessed you with it and you just wanted to give him some honor and glory and say that you preached Jesus after it was done. Just because you wrote Jesus into your new hairstyle. You hear what I'm saying? Yeah. People try to do that. Oh, praise God, it's not raining, and praise God and thank Jesus, amen. I preach the gospel. Anything. You can tell somebody about the rain. The gospel has to be, God chose it through the foolishness of preaching, men might be saved. We overcome by the word of our testimony, which is, I was born of the Spirit. Not I was once an idiot and I did all these terrible things. And no, I was born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. God changed my life, radically changed my life through the new birth. And here's how it happened. I called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, and the Holy Ghost came upon me, and He created a new man, a new being, a new me, which is Him, His life. And he fills you with the words of life, the words of the gospel, so that you can go and bear precious seed. And if you go bear precious seed, weeping or with compassion, you shall doubtless come again rejoicing. Hallelujah. Bringing the sheaves or the harvest with you. Where is it you reckon you're going to come rejoicing? You'll come again rejoicing. Where is that? Where reckon? Where is that? Church. Just think about it. When's the last time you brought a sheaf? When's the last time you had a harvest? Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. Huh? Where's Manny? Manny, you just participated in the harvest. You brought your girlfriend to church, and she got saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost. You brought us, did you know that? You brought somebody in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, I'm not going to say you need to go get yourself some more girlfriends. But I'm saying, okay. She's watching. I love you, Allie. But you can go find some more people. And you know, one of the great things too is where, you just begin to show people compassion, go show them love. Especially, I mean, come on, let God give you wisdom. Huh? But just go get people, bring them. Huh? Watch. Someone just walk out all upset and mad and don't agree with anything because they know the Bible. That's okay. Let's go get another one. Make your life about the kingdom. Make your life about reaching the lost. And everything's going to get really good. Turn your car over to Jesus. Huh? And fill it up with people. Bring them to church. Somebody said, I don't know where to go. You don't know where to go. Right by your house. Next door. And then from there, the next one down from there. And then the whole block. And then just work your way out from there. People want to go to the other side of town. You with me?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. Well, we love all of you. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Well, go rejoicing. Go rejoicing that you consecrated and committed yourself to live for Jesus from this day forward in a more radical way than you were living up to this point. Let tomorrow be different. Rewrite tomorrow.
Yes.
Yeah. Rewrite tomorrow. Before you go to bed, rewrite tomorrow.
Yes.
Write it. Yeah. Write it. Write out tomorrow. Write it now. Write God into it in a bigger way.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We love all of you dearly. Yeah.